As the Angels and White Sox battle for the top spot in the American League West, the veterans continue to play key roles. At age 37, Carlton Fisk remains the regular catcher for the Sox, and his 16 homers place him second behind Dave Kingman in the American League. At age 39, Reggie Jackson may not win any more home run titles, but he's got 10 for the season. And this week, he moved past Hall of Famers Mel Ott, Ernie Banks, and Eddie Matthews on the all-time list. It's the Angels and White Sox next on NBC.
Chicago White Sox. The Game of the Week is brought to you by Ford, who invites you to drive the new Ford Escort. Have you driven a Ford lately? By Miller Beer. Miller, made the American way since 1855. By your Firestone retailers coast to coast. Come on, America, drive over to Firestone. And by State Farm Insurance. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Beautiful day for baseball at Comiskey Park in Chicago. The first half of an NBC doubleheader with the White Sox playing host to the Angels. Hi, everybody. Bob Costas along with Tony Kubek. The Angels and White Sox continue to ride the seesaw in the American League West. They split four last weekend in Anaheim. Then last night here at Comiskey Park behind young Kirk McCaskill, the Angels beat Floyd Bannister and the White Sox 5-2. It's their turn to lead. They're up by half a game over the Sox in the American League West. Today's pitching pairing, Urbano Lugo, with a record of 1-1, will go for California, and he'll be opposed by the left-hander Tim Lawlor, the former Padre. He'll pitch for the White Sox. His record is 2-3. Anytime you find a club in the pennant race, one of the questions you ask about is their bullpen. In that case, you're talking Bob James for the White Sox and Donnie Moore for the Angels. Here they are with Tony.
All right, thanks, Bob. I want to ask you both the same question. Aside from having the opportunity this year to be closers, for your respective teams, what's been the biggest difference for you, Donnie, as far as becoming a successful stopper?
Well, the main thing with me now is I've come up with an off-speed pitch, which I've sorely needed all my career. And I always had the pitch, but I was kind of, you know, I didn't really want to use it that much because it seemed like every time I would throw it, I'd get up a chink hit or, you know, I'd walk a guy on it. But I had to go down to the minor leagues and when I was with the Braves, and I really worked on the pitch, and I, you know, I got real great confidence in it now. I can throw it anytime I want to. But that's a big difference for me now.
Bob, Donnie's talking about his split-fingered fastball or forkball. You, of course, got the great fastball up in the mid-90s sometimes in the curveball. But what would you say is your biggest success now?
I think, plain and simple, being able to get that curveball over. You know, you get, I don't care how hard you throw, you get guys looking for one pitch, and they're going to hit it. And like Donnie said, you know, I've had the curveball for a long time. It's just been a matter of being able to perfect it and get it over the plate. And I think that, quite simply, has been the big reason.
Wish we had more time to talk to you, too. We'll be back to Comiskey Park and the starting lineups right after this message.
Gene Mauk's lineup. Juan Benitez is at first base. He's the leadoff man. Dick Schofield Jr., the shortstop, batting second. Brian Downing is in left field. He'll hit third. The veteran Doug DeSense at third base. He had a home run last night, and he hits cleanup today. Against the left-hander Lawlor, Reggie Jackson will DH and bat fifth. Bobby Gritch at second base hitting sixth. Bob Boone, who swung a hot bat of late, is the catcher, batting seventh. Mike Brown in right field, and he'll hit eighth. And Gary Pettis is down in the ninth spot in the order, playing center field.
Defensively behind Tim Lawlor, the left-hander for the White Sox. Rudy Law in left field. Boy, he's been outstanding out there. Daryl Boston, the youngster, out in center field. Harold Baines in right. A little bit of a home run hitting slump lately. Luis Salazar, the Venezuelan, along with Ozzy Guillen, also from Venezuela, on the left side. Tim Hewlett, if you want a job for Julio Cruz, he's at second. Greg Walker, man they cannot afford to lose his bat. Pudge Fisk, Colin Fisk behind the plate after a night game. We talked about the old catchers and the veterans in the ballgame. Bob did in his opening. But Fisk and Boone, the catchers in today's game, and Lawler on the mound.
Lawler, as you may know, was acquired in that big deal with San Diego during the offseason. The White Sox gave up Lamar Hoyt principally, along with a couple of minor leaguers. In return for Lawler, Luis Salazar, Ozzie Guillen, and minor league pitcher Bill Long. The cliche, I think, holds up. A deal that may help both clubs. Hoyt is really hot now for the Padres, and Guillen looks like the long-term answer at shortstop, at least defensively for the White Sox. The jury may still be out on Lawler, but obviously he's part of their rotation, so that's a plus.
Well, I think he becomes much more important now, too, because Rich Dotson has had recurrent arm problems. In fact, he is scheduled on Monday to have an arteriogram to find out what specifically is wrong, and that's usually a last resort. It'll be a painful procedure where they inject the dye, and they want to take a look at the shoulder. So young Bruce Tanner, Chuckstone, in the starting rotation now along with Lawler, and they could both become very important with Dotson going down. Don't know for how long.
Bruce Tanner will pitch tomorrow against Mike Witt of the Angels. Lawler, at times, has been the odd man out in Tony La Russa's rotation this year. He's missed four starts already because of off days and rainouts. The last time he pitched was Sunday in Anaheim, and he lost to the man he opposes today, Urbano Lugo.
Dave Duncan, the White Sox pitching coach, of course, Tony La Russa, the manager, they oftentimes will use the men in their starting rotation to come out of the bullpen. They've done it with Seaver, they've done it with Burns, they've done it with Lawler. They feel that if it's a guy's time to throw 2 days after he starts, why not let him get his work out of the mound if he's going to let it all out? So Lawler's done both. It's a relief. He started. Two interesting teams, Bob. White Sox just a half a game back to California Angels now. Kansas City 2.5. Oakland 3. Very surprising. Kingman with another home run taking the American League leadership. But these two teams sit in 13th and 14th place as far as team batting. They are 1-3 as far as team pitching, so that'll show the importance of the pitching and defense.
In their four-game series last weekend in Anaheim, which they split, you see the Red Sox out in front of the American League and the White Sox and Angels down at the bottom. The teams each scored 9 runs total in the four games. Close ball games, and each won 2. Let's take a look at last night's results. California, as you know, beat the White Sox 5-2. The Yankees with Lou Whitaker homering. Lost to Detroit 6-4. Toronto beat Boston 7-2. Minnesota, in Ray Miller's debut, is a 3-2 winner with 2 runs in the bottom of the ninth. I'll tell you what you're looking at, they've got Texas and Minnesota. Okay, there it is. Let's try and line it up here. Minnesota beat Texas by a score of 3-2. I'm just continuing down my own list, folks. It's too difficult to figure out where they are. Seattle, Kansas City postponed by rain. Oakland over Cleveland 9-1. Don Sutton won as he continues his pursuit of 300 lifetime victories.
Toronto's got to be happy to get home, Bob, after that 3-7 road trip. He was swept by Boston. Beat Boston 2 in a row up there.
Milwaukee over Baltimore 13-10. So California by half a game over the White Sox, 2.5 over KC. In the East, it's Toronto by 2.5 over Detroit, 5.5 over the Red Sox. Orioles trail by 6.5. Yankees 7.5 back. The red-hot Juan Benitez, hitting better than 400 in the month of June, steps in and takes high for a ball. He went 4-for-5 last night.
He is a very valuable man at Gene Mock. He's already played 5 positions this year, including shortstop, first base, third, the outfield.
He was co-MVP in the California Angels team last year, along with Brian Downing. Big hit.
And another base hit for Benitez.
For Gene Mock, in game number 65, this is his 63rd different lineup, and they talk about the value of a manager. I really think, Bob, that before the game starts, the manager, the way Gene Mock shuffles his players around and his talent around, that's when they win or lose ballgames. Once the game starts, some strategic moves with setting that lineup, nobody does it better than Mock.
Schofield is hitting just 200, but he has occasional power. He put 5 over the fence this year.
Early, an awful lot. And last time around, managing, he led the league in sacrifice. He's doing that presently, so he does it for purpose. Not always just to get that one run early, but to get the men in at the corners to give his hitters more hitting room.
Texas plate umpire Larry Barnett. He's the crew chief. You can see where Salazar was playing. There's Barnett. All you need is Ed Arbister in that picture, along with Fisk, and you got the picture complete from the 75 World Series game.
Sure, Barnett would just as soon forget about it.
He's a good umpire. In fact, I think that incident, as much pressure as there was on him with the death threats, has made him a better umpire. He really works. Tony La Russa said he may be the best ball strike man in this league.
Shallow right field, and moving over from center field to make the catch is Darryl Boston.
About that to take a charge, huh? The wind is blowing out of the northwest, which will push anything out to right field. There's the flag. This is different than last night. Last night, the wind was out of the south, blowing a gale out to left. The cool front has moved in. A great park. English Park in baseball. What, 75th anniversary will be celebrated in July.
This is where Joe Louis first claimed the heavyweight championship, 1937, I believe, against James Braddock. Downing is in a horrendous slump, 0 for 4 last night, 4 for his last 61, to drop his average under 200 at 194.
Angels, a very patient hitting ball club. They throw a lot of bases on balls on the board. Their batting average might be low, but their on-base average or percentage of the team is very good.
Ball strike one. We told you about Barnett behind the plate. Ken Kaiser is at first, Dale Ford at second, and John Hirschbeck at third. How about the stories out of Baltimore, where the Orioles say their radar gun cannot get accurate readings when Big Ken Kaiser is behind home plate at almost 300 pounds. He says he just simply blocks the mechanism out.
A hatchet, that was his wrestling name.
Rip foul.
Interesting when you set a lineup up, Bob. You look at the number three hitter, Downey, you just mentioned his atrocious slump that he's in. He's hitting just 198, and yet Mock knows he will throw bases on balls on the board to keep an inning going. To get to the hot hitters, the Sensei who drives in runs, and Jackson who's been driving in runs. He wants a guy in there, even though he's hitting 198 in the three slot, to keep things going.
Lawler's ahead of him 0-2. And the count holds there. Lawler is 29 years old. Native of Poplar Bluff, Missouri, 6'3 and 195. A good hitter who doesn't get that chance now that he's over in the American League.
He takes batting practice on occasion, especially with Kittle and Jerry Harrison were gone for about a week. Problems in their families. Russo did not fear using him as a pinch hitter if he could.
He was 11 and 13 last year for the pennant-winning Padres. Fists and down the left field line. Let's see if it stays in play. Rudy Law, does he come out with the ball?
Boy, he really hit that either hip or rib cage.
The Wallace kid's got padded, the ball.
Wallace padded out there. That's been always been a tricky spot. Right where his feet are, there's a little graded tip. Concrete, you get in the corner. It happened to Law yesterday on a ground ball. He knows the wind is pushing this ball back toward the playing surface. It looked like it was going to be 8-10 rows back, but that crosswind out of the northwest. What an effort by Rudy Law. Boy, he's been something. When he played center field for La Russa a couple of years ago, last season, his arm was a little short. It was a little bit erratic out there, but left field is his spot now when Darryl Boston plays. Lawler with a running fastball and tail away, has a good slider. Be his best pitch in a straight change. Can't be erratic with his control.
And that's a base hit for Downing, and as he runs down toward first base, he throws up his arms in jubilation. He was 4 for his last 61 before that base hit. Look at that. He tips his cap to the Angel dugout.
He's getting a hand from some of the players. Typical leadoff hitter, but boy, he did a job for several years in that spot.
Vicente continues to play through the pain of that chronic bad back. It had him on the disabled list about a month or so ago. Since he's returned, he's hit safely in 15 of 16 games and had a homer last night. Rips this one down the left field line and it's foul.
He's just rolling that slider over. He did it to Downing and now he does it to Vicente. More on a flat play than any downward action. Most of those pitching coaches, from the left-hander to right-hander, they want that slider about belt high to come in right underneath the hand. Pitch that Stan Musial always said it was the most difficult pitch for him to hit.
Recently read a Ted Williams comment about Musial that I found interesting. He said Musial was the only hitter he ever saw who made not a single adjustment with two strikes on him. Didn't move his hands a millimeter on the bat. That's fouled away. Three good swings at least every time up for Stan the Man. Never conceded anything, said Williams, and he said he admired that.
Two base runners. This has been a problem for the Angels. They have left more runners on base than any other team in the American League. Conversely, the White Sox have left fewest runners on base than any other team, and that's the legacy of the late Charlie Lau and his situational hitting field in theory. There's changing signs now. Benica is down at second base. Lauer and Punch Fist want to get it all straightened out. White Sox are going to get a home ball club, Bob. They've best record in the American League at home.
They're 20-9 here at Comiskey. Overall, 34-28.
See if he goes after Vicente inside. Vicente has learned to hit the ball to right center with authority. Close stance.
Sensei skies it to Law in left field. That's the second out.
Wind and sun will affect outfielders more than infielders today. That is a ball that last night, with that wind going out to left, you see what it's doing now at the right, might have been out of here. This has become an outstanding hitter's park. Years ago, he could hit a ball here with a cannon. It was unusual to hit a ball on the roof.
Who went about a month without a homer, broke out of it against the White Sox last weekend in Anaheim, and then hit two more in Cleveland when they went on the road. 5-13 lifetime. Check swing foul.
Reggie broke that home run drought against the guy in the mound, Tim Lauer. He hit home run 5-11. Career off Lauer, and that tied him for 12th with Mel Ott. He had injured a leg. He pulled a hamstring. Wasn't disabled, but he said it set his stroke back.
He's in a groove now, and he says, quite candidly, I used to be able to do it for 3 or 4 months. Now I can do it for 3 or 4 days. The 0-1. A ball and a strike. Jackson says when he's hitting well, he's in control of his body, not lunging at the ball. When he lunges at the ball and gets over-anxious, that's when you see him pull the outside pitch and hit all those weak ground balls to second base. When he's hitting well, he'll go to the opposite field, and of course, with his great strength, he can hit the ball over the fence in left center.
Bobby talks a lot about his lower body and his feet and balance, more so than the hands, shoulders, and head, and he said, my feet, as you said, are in control, and I have good balance, I'll hit. He's moved off the plate, maybe 6 to 8 inches this year, and closed his stance a little bit. To see what it looks like.
Here's Lawler's 1-1 pitch. Ball and two strikes to Reggie Jackson.
When Charlie Lau, we mentioned him before, was the hitting instructor of the Yankees, Reggie had a 299 and a 300 year. He was more on the plate, slightly open stance. Steve Mock told him in the spring of the year, first thing, Reggie, I won't be able to stand you this year if you strike out as much as you did last year. He said, just put the ball and play more. He has really made his swing, as you saw by that replay, a little bit shorter, a little more compact now as he's gotten older.
With two on and two out, Lawler fans Jackson to end the first. No runs, a couple of hits, and two are left. Rudy Law is the leadoff man in Tony La Russa's lineup. Tim Hewlett bats second and plays second base. Harold Baines in right field hitting third. Greg
Greg Walker, the cleanup man and first baseman. Carlton Fisk with those 16 homers, bats fifth and catches. Ron Kittle has returned after almost a week's absence. He's the designated hitter, hitting sixth. Darryl Boston in center field. Ozzie Guillen, the shortstop. There's Ozzie. And at third base, the former Padre, Luis Salazar.
Behind Urbano Lugo, Venezuela, Brian Downing, with a very, very high lifetime fielding average for outfielders. Gary Pettis, he can go line to line. Mike Brown in right. Doug DeCinse, third base. Ducky Skid, Dick Schofield at short. Bobby Gritch at second. Juan Benitez in first. Bob Boone catching, with Boone behind the plate last year anyway. The team ERA was about a run lower with Booney. That's how valuable he is. And Urbano Lugo. Don't call me Raphael anymore.
I don't know what Harry Rasmussen started a few years ago. He decided he'd rather be known as Eric, and now everybody's changing their name. Jose Gonzalez is now Jose Uribe. Rafael Lugo, now Urbano Lugo. His dad was a pitching legend in Venezuela. Urbano Lugo was a double-A at Waterbury last year. He was 13-8. Opened this year with their triple-A farm team in Edmonton. Came up in late April. This is his third game started, and they've also used him as a long man.
He and Lawler teamed up against each other again in California, and Lugo won out. Donnie Moore finished the ball game, but he struck out nine. He learned that forkball, some say a doctored pitch, from his pops in Venezuela. There it is. Right off the bat, he comes up with a forkball. He's got a curve. Runs the fastball away, a straight change in the forkball. I think Boone got crossed up on the first pitch.
Marcel Lachman, the pitching coach for the Angels, characterizes Lugo's forkball as a true forkball, not to be confused with the split-fingered fastball, which is all the rage now. And a lot of people are using those terms as synonymous. And he says they are not. With the true forkball, you're pushing the ball deeper into the space between the index and middle finger, and you're applying greater pressure as you release it from your hand. 2-0.
Drew Sutter's split finger, that's the pitch that Mike Marshall, the former great reliever, called the one-finger curveball. His will look like a screwball at times. Lugo's almost has, think of a tumbling action, a little bit of overspin, almost no spin at all, and it goes straight down in the hitting area. Center field with that high-powered lens, and it seems to be a little wobbly. It is because of that very, very high wind that is rocking the platform. So hang on out there, guys.
Here's the bunt, but it's foul.
Boone tried to fool the home plate umpire, Larry Barnett. He was in fair territory, which doesn't matter where the ball is. Hawk Harrelson, Ken Harrelson, who does some games for NBC, is one of the White Sox television broadcasters, along with Don Drysdale. Said he batted against Lugo's dad in Venezuelan Winter League. He said, yep. He said, this Lugo, Urbano, is just like his father. They both have that great, as he calls it, Cuban palm ball or fork ball. George Bamford calls it a Staten Island sinker. Talking about a football, folks.
Whatever it was, it worked on Rudy Law.
White Sox radar gun, and that's not always the accurate criteria as we look at him swing right over the top of that fork ball. We'll call it that for the rest of the game, but White Sox had him up to almost 90 miles an hour with his fastball, so you can't just sit on an off-speed pitch on Lugo.
Julio Cruz has had trouble earlier this year with a knee injury, and his batting average is beneath 200, so they're going with Tim Hewlett at second base, where he also played last night. Strike one. They played him at third some when Cruz came back, and he had problems with his fielding. But La Russa says he's not concerned with that. He says Hewlett has a great natural ability of field. And his problems at third, as he lines this one right at Schofield for the second out, his problems at third simply could be attributed to discomfort. He says once he sees 200-300 batted balls from that vantage point, he thinks that Hewlett will be a good third baseman, and that might be where he'll wind up when Cruz settles back in at second.
You've got time to play your hop. Third base, whatever hop catches you, in between, long, short, you don't have time to react. That might have been their MVP the first month of the season when he got off his best start.
Hewlett's been their most consistent player, but I think the MVP of this club has been fifth. Ooh.
Strike one to Baines. After that red-hot start, he went into an 0-for-26 dive and now has righted himself, hitting safely in 13 of his last 15 games. He was 2-for-4 last night. 1-1.
They are really jamming Baines. He's been an advocate, and Mike Lum is now their hitting coach, who's an advocate of like Walter Riddick in Boston. Look at that camera wobble out there from center field. But sometimes Baines gets to shifting his weight past his front foot, caught a lunging, and they really jam him. He's not pulling the ball much at all.
Downing, with the shades drawn, makes the catch. And Lugo sets the White Sox down in order in the last of the first. No score after one at Comiskey Park. Good crowd on hand at Comiskey Park. On the pregame show, Len Berman talked about an all-Canadian World Series as a possibility with the Blue Jays and Expos doing as well as they are. I guess you'd have to say that an all-Chicago World Series isn't out of the question. And where they would play some of the games would be a major question.
Well, I believe the state legislature now in Illinois, if the Cubs should make it, that they can play some night games with temporary lights. Don't know if Dallas Green and company would go along with that or not. He's already said they'd rather play their games if they can't in their park, play them in a National League park, not here on the south side.
Of course, first, they've got to snap that losing streak, which is now at 10. Gritch takes high for a ball. It won't be easy against the Cardinals. Boy, is Whitey Herzog's team playing good baseball.
Something stops scoring runs, haven't they? This is Chase Stadium.
That's beat him four straight. And last night, Cardinals took him 7-5. I see Willie McGee has moved past Tommy Herr in the first place in the National League batting race. Boy, did he wear the White Sox out last season. 2-0.
Gritch hit what, 720 against the White Sox last year. He just was really on a tear. Bobby Knopp, who played some baseball here for Don Gutteridge a couple of years as a second baseman down to Kansas City. And Angel ball says, boy, could he turn a double play and cover ground. Bobby Knopp, number one down at first base.
No score in the top of the second. First of a doubleheader on NBC today. Most of you will see the Tigers and the Yankees in the second half with Vince Scully and Joe Garagiola. 2-1.
White Sox have played a couple of less games than the Angels, but to give you a comparison to how patient a team California is, they already have 285 bases on balls. The White Sox have 101 less, 184. I guess the story for the Angels will be like last year. If the older players don't wear down or get injured, they'll stay it all the way. But boy, they, under Gene Mock this year. But they could wear down again and suffer the injuries. The Cruz and the Jacksons and DeCinte with his back. Benitez. Gene Mock has done it. He's moved in a lot of rookie pitchers. Last year, John McNamara put Schofield and Pettis in the lineup, two rookies. Dean Mott, most remembered for the 64 season. He took that team farther than any right to be. They didn't have the talent some of the other clubs in that league that year.
Gritch draws a walk to open the second. Well, we mentioned the Cubs' 10-game losing streak at present. Mott knows all about 10-game losing streaks. That was the figure that did him and the Phillies in September of 1964. Like they had it wrapped up, and the Cardinals caught them and won the pennant on the last day.
Watch this new stance by Boone. Moose Tubing, the third base coach and hitting instructor, said, Bob, you've got too much head movement, too much sway. He's not even going to stride from this, he said. You want to got to start hitting more with only your hand. Cut down the head movement to stay on the ball better. Get that bat hit out. He's called Ozark Ike, hit like that. He's a lot stronger than Boone. Gus Zernio. Bob Lemon looked that way. Formerly a coach of the Twins and also a manager. Jim Lemon, excuse me. Bob Lemon, the Hall of Fame pitcher, now still working for the Yankees out west.
And Gritch is back easily.
in May, Bob Boone has hit about 330, hiking his average from 185 to his present 263. Tries to bunt and fouls it off.
Not a sacrifice. He thought he had Salazar back. Give an example of what Gene Mock, throwing his thoughts into the opposition, sacrificing so much. Not always, as we said, to play for one run, but to keep those men tight at the corner. Leading right now is 39, as the graphic indicates. Just finally can't stump in. Can you say something there? He's got that baby up there.
Working in the truck today, along with producer John Filippelli and director Harry Coyle. The 0-2. Out of play. It's an interesting study at home plate right now as Fisk returns. Boone at the plate and Fisk behind it. A pair of 37-year-old catchers, each catching a day game after a night game. The only catcher 37 years old or older in Major League history to have caught better than 100 games in a season, the former White Sox backstop, Sherman Lawler, who did it in the early 60s. Both these guys will do it, barring injury, this season. Again, the 0-2. In on the fifth and a pop-up on the infield. Hewlett is run off by Guillen, and it drops. They'll get the force anyway. They'll get the force, so there will be no error. Actually, it might be a good exchange for them because Boone doesn't run as well as Gray.
One of those is Boone mad at himself that he got jammed. Didn't really run hard. This obviously is not done on purpose. It is the wind and the sun. He bent over knowing the problem that sun and wind can cause. He lost the ball right there. He yelled out to Ozzie Guillen, the shortstop, and then he picked it up again, but then the wind took over. Guillen took that to Salazar. Is that who the man was who took the force at second?
Right fielder Mike Brown takes the ball.
Good power to right center field. You get the ball out. There's the lawyer, Tony La Russa. Two media accounts keep saying he's in trouble, but the owners here are so loyal.
Gardner became the fourth manager to go already this year, joining Yogi Berra, Doug Rader, and Joe Aldavelli. Former Orioles pitching coach Ray Miller, now the manager in Minnesota.
Ray the pitcher blasting.
And drilling one to deep left.
Then might kill it, or will it?
It's not killing this one.
Wow.
It's in the upper deck.
Yesterday, that ball was at least on the roof or over. The wind killed that ball. It's still in the edge of the facade. Is he strong? Rumors of that guy. A lot of people were looking for right-handed hitters, including the White Sox, Toronto, that Mike Brown is going to be a player to leave here before the June 15th trading deadline. He got an awful lot of that one. So the shaded glasses help.
A lot of players are going with that nowadays. Mookie Wilson and George Foster with the Mets. Going with that cool look at the plate.
Well, he wears glasses anyway, but he just doesn't have to wear the eye blacks. He needs his eyeballs and his bright sun.
There was no wind anywhere that was going to kill that one.
Mm-mm.
You need a hurricane to beat it down. Pettis is in the ninth spot and, in effect, a second leadoff man once they turn the order over once. And the way Benitez has been hitting, it's a good move because it gives Benitez a chance to occupy more of an RBI position.
Strategies with the DH, the American League, that has evolved over the last few years, where you put speed. Toronto puts Tony Fernandez nine most of the time. Alfredo Griffin hits the ninth spot for Jackie Moore's Ultimate A's.
Pettis is a switch hitter. He's now tied with Ricky Henderson for the league lead in stolen bases at 28. Henderson is playing spectacular ball for the Yanks. His average is a 357, tops in the American League. Fouled off and it holds 1-2.
So Gene Mock and Reggie, everybody was talking clubhouse before, because there's no hitting today because of an event with the Shriners, which literally, because they were talking about Henderson. And Mock said, you know, if he was not in that ballpark, the way he's swinging the bat now, he might be the first 44 man, 40 home runs, 40 stolen bases. Reggie, 40 is hard to come by.
Walker fields it.
Look at him go.
Lawler and Pettis beat it.
He dropped the ball, but it was beaten out by Pettis. Even from the right side, when he took the first couple of steps, and Bob, he didn't get a good jump out of the box because he popped the ball and he was fooled. And once he took two or three steps, he was in full stride. It's like a changeup or a sinker. Lawler knew he had to get over. You can hear Kyle Fisk yelling, get over. And Ken Kaiser gives the same sign, says it's no contest.
Pettis is aboard. He's stolen 28 in 32 attempts, but he has not been trying that often lately. He was thrown out by Carlton Fisk last night. He's run only five times in his last 15 games.
He was out with a sprained ankle. Nice block by Fisk. That saves the base right there.
Pettis also had another injury. He strained his right shoulder while adjusting the front seat of his car, and Moss said, hey, if I knew this was going to happen, I would have hired him a chauffeur.
It's a tie. Pettis and Henderson with Collins in the three spot. The Oakland A's didn't have a real big lead.
He doesn't take a lead like that other scintillating young base stealer, Vince Coleman of the Cardinals.
He's out there about 20 feet, it seems like, at times.
16, they say, on a regular basis.
Joe Morgan used to take those measure leads. We heard from him interviewing Pete Rose for the pregame show. Joe used to measure about 15 feet. 12 feet. I really believe Coleman has got to be a little bit longer.
Well, Lou Brock was saying that he used to take a lead on average about 12 feet, and he feels that Coleman is out there 16, 17 feet regularly. Pitch, but first to throw over.
One thing with base stealers like Coleman or Pettis or Henderson, a pitcher cannot let that base stealer dominate his thought. And that happens so often. Make up your mind what you're going to do, how many times you're going to throw over, and say, now the man with the bat, the guy can hurt me most.
In the air to deep
center
field.
Get this one.
Boston going back and watching it leave.
To the center field fence. That has helped this park, the better hitters park. And also, when Bill Beck was here, they put that electronic scoreboard in dead center field. That wind had a habit of coming off Lake Michigan and blowing straight into hitter's face. Used to kill a lot of balls. Not anymore.
2-1.
That pushed Benitez's ball out. Straight out to right field.
The walking definition of the term hot hitter is Dave Duncan along with Tony La Russa. Benitez is hitting about 420 this month. He was 4-for-5 last night and has a single and a homer to open up his day this afternoon.
Consultant, a man named Ed Walsh, a
pitcher. And Ed Walsh, as you would imagine, said, let's make it a great pitcher's park, which they did initially, but not anymore.
Did he go around? He did. He's gone.
And he's got his slider down in the strike zone. That baby really breaks off. A little bit of Guidry in his prime or Parky Lyle. A swerve. It may have taken a little something off the slider. A little bit bigger breaking ball.
Big Ed Walsh wanted everything his way. The dead ball wasn't enough for him, huh? Didn't even have to face Babe Ruth yet, although he did have to contend with Ty Cobb. He said, make the fence far, far away, and with this dead ball, he'll never hit it out of here.
I wonder if Al Lopez, a former great White Sox and Cleveland manager, is listening down in Tampa, Ybor City area. Used to freeze those baseballs along with Stanky and Richards when the Yankees and power hitting clubs come in here. And they were known as the hitless wonders, the White Sox. Can't do that anymore. There's a lot better quality control.
They used to put the baseballs in the refrigerator,
oh,
right?
It was incredible. You pick it up, it was a mush ball. You, like a snowball you throw across the infield. Or so we thought. Al Lopez would have admitted. Senor, as honest a person as he is.
Two outs, nobody on, and four runs home in the Angels' second.
Wow.
Scatters them in our little camera well down there. Gotta stay alert, boys. The youngster came out with a souvenir. Here's the 1-2. 2-2. A
lot of kids in the ballpark. No batting practice today, no infield practice. The Shriners, who do such good work with hospitals for children. Billy Pierce, head of the athletic chapter here, former great White Sox and Giant pitcher. Got about 3,000 kids parading around in Little League uniforms. It's quite a sight before the game, wasn't it? In fact, they're sitting all over this ballpark in these multicolored uniforms, a lot of them out in center field, right center field, the upper deck.
Has been touched for two homers in this inning and a pair of loud fouls, one by Schofield, and now Downing sends one over the roof. Foul. That's also out of play. I see that Lawler is cultivating the Sal Magley look. Going unshaven. I don't know if that's a beard in process or just the growth between starts.
Donnie Moore, so clean. Are you those stoppers, the Suters, the Gossages? They look so ominous. The facial hair, clean.
This ball is well hit. Rudy Law in pursuit, and it's off the wall. He makes a good pickup, but Downing is in with a double. A day of liberation for him. A single and a double after he came in 4-for-61.
So perhaps we'll have a hitter's game between these two teams before this day is over with. Something down in there, breaking ball or off-speed pitch. He busted him in with fastballs, and Downing had turned on him pretty well. The ball just misses, going above the yellow line, the home run marker. They can differentiate between the fans reaching over into the playing field or not. Looks like it missed by about a foot or less.
Dave Duncan talking with Lawler and Fitz.
Who's pitched very, very well after a shaky start for the White Sox. That was an area. Getting to Bob James, who's been such a good closer for them. And LaRusso and Duncan were worried about. But Dean Nelson pitched very well. They brought Juan Augusto back up after they sent him down. He's starting to pitch well. Filler's been very, very good lately.
And since they fly to left his first time, where the Angels continue their pursuit of Bert Blyleven, but the White Sox blocked it by claiming Blyleven on waivers this week.
Well, they said they blocked it, but if Dotson's got more serious problems, they hope he does, and we do too. They're not claiming to stop him. They're claiming to get him and put him in a starting rotation. Maybe some other teams are.
What
would it take, though? Minnesota apparently offered the second baseman Tim Tuffle, catcher Dave Engel, and a minor leaguer. And the Indians said, okay, give us Mike Smithson, too. And Flynn said, whoa.
Well, I think next year, Blylevin, or after this year, becomes a 10-5 man where he can veto a lot of trades and do a lot of things.
This one is off the fifth. Hewlett backs up. And the second inning is over for the Angels, but not before they score four times on a pair of two-run homers. Mike Brown and Juan Benitez connecting, and Lawler trails 4-0. Comiskey Park as it looked a half century or more ago, and Tony was talking about how moving home plate further out toward the fences and the changing of some of the configuration in the outfield has helped the home run hitters. Well, in 72 years, there were 20 home runs hit on the roof here, and in the last couple years, there have been 13 homers hit over the roof, including two this season, one by Kirk Gibson of the Tigers in right field, and Fitz put one over the roof in left field.
And appropriately, the first man ever to hit a ball over that roof, you guessed it, the Bambino, Babe Ruth back in 27.
Cooper's Park in a quick 4.5 months. It cost about $600,000.
A bargain even then. Walker's pop
Look
up
out.
The foul ground, and DeSante just cannot find it.
He knew the wind was going to push it right back to him. We saw Egan and Hewlett last inning have trouble. Jimmy Leland getting out of the way, and he just drives him right to his knees. There are just a couple of little wispy clouds. So those little white angels as the outfielders saw him not helping out these infielders today. Even with the sunglasses down, the ball in the center of the sun, Schofield can't get over in time to help out. Sunglasses don't help no matter how dark they are if it stays right in the middle of it.
There's no error charge, just a no play. And Walker is given a second life. It's hard and foul.
Hit over the roof, and that gale force wind is blowing out to right field. And very few balls hitting that center field bleachers. Bill Veeck talks about great Josh Gibson, who hit two when the plate was back in that center field bleacher. One game, say the greatest hitter I'd ever seen.
Same architect designed this park as designed Wrigley Field.
About it. It's a ballpark. It's not one of those modern aberrations of cold stainless steel and concrete, but a ballpark. Of which there are too few now. Did Walker go around? They check at third base, and John Hirschbeck says no. So it's 1-2.
If we live alone long enough, someday we'll see all dome stadiums, all artificial surface. That was a fluff ball from Lugo, a curveball.
Boone will toss it down to first since he didn't handle it cleanly, and Lugo records his second strikeout.
You're watching two of the best of the business. You talked about the veterans, Boone and Fisk. Well, they talk about framing the plate. Watch Boone and Fisk defensively and how they try and jerk those six-inch pitches or two inches off the edge back into the strike zone and deceive the home plate umpire.
Too many as good as these two in baseball.
Lugo's first one to Fisk. Slow breaking ball swung on and missed. Murphy hit his 17th last night for Atlanta as they split a doubleheader. And so Kingman and Murphy are tied for the Major League lead. Braves splitting with the Reds. Pete Rose had one hit. He needs 45 now. 1-1.
Fisk will take a pitch in that shoulder. In fact, the last road trip, he was at 4 or 5 times. Three of them in that left shoulder when he turns it in. He had a little damage to that shoulder, some hemorrhaging. He's been beaten up, and he just keeps going out there.
this past offseason as a chiropractor also. Dr. Claus, he got this kind of what he calls plyometric.
Check swing roller with Benitez handles, and Lugo does it. Gotta be E1 as Fisk is aboard.
Benitez, I don't know if he had a good grip on it, but he throws Lugo a changeup. He fingers it, throws it flat-footed, hits off the webbing of the glove, air to Lugo. Off-speed pitch from Benitez, though, timing a little bit. You got to be careful of Fisk, too. The other day against Oakland, a couple days ago, against Bill Kruger, left-hander, he stole second and third consecutively. Can't take him for granted.
You look at that 190 and you say Kittle is having a terrible time, but that's 190 and climbing. He was around 140 a month ago. Inside to him. He missed a week of action when he and his wife, Lori, lost their newborn son.
He was really smoking with a home run bat before he left. A couple days of extra hitting practice to get back on the beam. Mike Lum, finally, a couple of weeks back, got Kittle to bend his knees, crouch, get a better perspective of the strike zone, and relax. He couldn't reach breaking balls away or low pitches. Just slight crouch now.
Saw one of Kittle's buddies earlier this week in New York. Wayne Gretzky was there to pick up another 7 or 8 awards. I don't know where he's keeping them all. And he went out to the ballpark to see Dwight Gooden pitch against the Cubs. Kittle and Gretzky became friends when Ron was playing in the minor leagues at Edmonton. Here he hits 50 homers and batted almost 350. Minor league player of the year.
We mentioned another one of his buddies earlier. Look at Chris down at first. Look at that walking lead to take off. But Billy Pierce is the guy who rediscovered him in Gary. That lot of baseball at the Dodgers. Kittle had back problems. Let Kittle go. Billy Pierce saw this. Somebody better go over and take a look at this guy. He's got some power. 67 home runs in his first two major league seasons. Ron Kittle.
He's had some rooftoppers. Here's the 2-2 pitch.
Look, lined. It's off Lugo's glove.
And backhand. Man. Oh, what a play! And safe at first. Attention, Mel Allen and all the folks at this week in
football. Hey, he's got him in a rundown. He thought he was out at first.
You're right.
He thought he was out.
And it becomes a double play.
You betcha.
Center of the diamond. What a great play. And it winds up a double play when Kittle, in his confusion, thinks he's already out and turns back into the base.
There is nobody better than Bobby Gretsch at playing his pitcher, hitter, situation account. He just robbed Kittle of a single. This might have ended up on third. A little slip toss to Schofield. And then Kaiser had called him safe. Kittle thought he had called him out. He rounded the bag and kind of was trotting towards second base. And then Benitez realized he was called safe by Ken Kaiser and tagged him. It's a funny double play. I don't know if they'll call it a double play because it's almost two separate plays.
It is.
The force out, Steelers tries to second base, and then the action stopped, and then Kittle by rounding the base, and Benitez chased him down. Well, let's get to this now. All-time home run leader.
As we said earlier, moved past Ott, Matthews, and Banks, and next ahead, McCovey and Williams. At 5:21, 105. Tap foul. Reggie's got a good chance to wind up, let's see what would it be, 3, 4, 5, 6 on the list. He could move past Mickey Mantle, who's at 5:36, but next ahead of Mantle is Killebrew at 5:73, and then Frank Robinson's a little bit further ahead, so it's not likely that Reggie can overtake Killebrew at 573, but he could move past Mantle if he hits 24 more.
That he's playing at least next year.
Well, for those who like to be official about these sort of things, the official score has now changed his mind. At first, he ruled it two separate plays. Now he's simply decided to call it a double play. The net result is exactly the same, two outs on one ball.
Angels leading the league in double plays. Gene Mock says that's not always a good sign. He said many times, like most times, when you lead the league in double plays because you're putting too many base runners on.
Some of those old Pittsburgh Pirates teams years ago, they lead the double play, leading double plays. They have base runners all over the place. Sometimes it's a sign of poor pitching staff.
2-2 to Reggie.
Bob Gallus today, the official scorer here in Comiskey Park.
Full count. Rickson made that stupendous backhand stop and flip. It was really the flip off balance that made it such a spectacular play. As good as the initial grab was. And the 3-2 to Reggie. He walked it. This is the second straight inning. Lawler has opened with a walk. He passed Gritch to start the four-run second. You may recall it was Lawler's control, at least in part, that did him in Game 3 of the World Series in Detroit. He lasted just an inning and two-thirds, during which time he walked four and gave up four hits, took the loss. Tigers began to assert control of the series. None of the Padres starters fared very well, either in the LCS or in the World Series. Swing and a miss by Gritch.
And Reggie Jackson down at first can lull a pitcher to sleep.
He's one of only four players in Major League Baseball history has hit over 500 home runs and stolen over 200 bases.
Mays, Frank Robinson, the other three.
Oh, and two to Gritch.
Here's where he gets stuck. You start listing your best two strike hitters. Put Gritch right there. He can work that count to 3-2 in a hurry.
When he was in the prime of his career, he'd draw close to 100 walks a season, and he'd also hit you 25, sometimes 30 home runs. He was a great offensive player for someone playing any position, and especially for a middle infielder.
He's walked over 100 times twice in the Major League. Both time with the Orioles.
A call, strike three. Let's check with Bill McAtee in New York.
All right, Bob, watch this play in Cincinnati. Dave Parker with a bloop single into center. The usually reliable Dale Murphy can't get the ball. And then as Davey Concepcion goes to third, Murphy throws the ball away. So Dale Murphy is charged with two errors on the play. Concepcion scores, and the Reds lead it 2-1 in the top of the fourth.
So now it's Bob Boone with one out and one on, taking a strike. He credits the Phillies conditioning coach, Gus Heffling. His longevity, he said, were not for Gus Heffling, and the paces he put me through and the things he taught me while I was with the Phillies, I might not be in the major leagues at all, let alone catching 100 plus games a year at age 37.
He's not the only one. Jerry Krugman, who's just back off the disabled list, credits him. Bill Campbell, who's with the Phillies, has moved down to the Cardinals. Gus Heffling's got a great tape on conditioning and strength and flexibility. Fisk is involved. Mike Schmidt's involved in it.
The 0-2.
Uh-oh.
Chopper down to third. Salazar's throw to second. One and on to first for the double play.
I thought that ball was going to get in the sun the way he put his glove in front of his face.
So after 2.5, the Angels lead the White Sox 4-0.
Roger Bosser, the third generation of groundskeepers here, has a little hard in front of home plate now. The White Sox getting down to the ball, good thick grass. Luis Salazar has played center field, starts the double play around the horn. Uncle Gene Bosser, who tailored that 59 infield for the White Sox with Aparicio and Landis and Fox. Bunts never rolls foul. They still don't down the third baseline here.
I see where they're having an old-timers game here at Comiskey next month, reuniting the 59 White Sox and the L.A. Dodgers, who beat them in six games in the World Series.
And they found, you know who?
Al Smith.
Where'd they find him?
I don't know. They had a manhunt going on for him. They couldn't locate him for a couple of months. They wanted him back for the old-timers game, their left fielder. They'll bring him back, and maybe someone will pour a beer into his face along the left field wall.
Classic photograph, wasn't it?
Darryl Boston, quickly behind on the count 0-2. They know Boston can play center field. You're seeing two of the best defensive center fielders, young defensive center fielders in the game today, and Pettis and Boston. They'd like him to produce offensively, as he did in the minors. So far, that hasn't happened. He's at 228.
Well, they think he can handle a fastball down in the strike zone, but that off-speed stuff gives him trouble. Breaking balls, a changeup. Not unusual for young hitters. Some like Reggie Jackson, he used a breaking ball when he first came up, and then only because he saw so many, he's become more of a fastball hitter.
Swing and a miss, strike three, and that's the third strikeout recorded by Lugo.
Got pretty good movement on his fastball. He changed his speed on it well. Here to have a little hop on at a time. Gets the ball up in the high 80s with that fork ball. He's a speed pitch. He can be very effective.
0-1 to Guillen. When Lugo beat the White Sox last weekend in Anaheim, he went 8 innings and he struck out 9. He's been 3 so far today. 1-1.
See, last year, Mike Port over there, taking over for Bubsy Bavasi with the Angels. Port, now the general manager, has done a good job helping to build his farm system. A bunch of kid pitchers up now. Moved Pettis, as we told you, in Schofield last year. This year they got about 5 rookie pitchers. Romana came in the rotation last year, with the year before. From the staff that was almost ancient, a couple of years ago, moving to Houston.
Gotten good work of late from the youngsters. Romanek pitched a shutout Thursday against Cleveland. McCaskill gave him 7-plus good innings last night in a 5-2 win. Lugo today and Witt scheduled tomorrow. Red Sox in front at Toronto in the third. Red Sox cooled off a little bit the last few days, but were they ever on fire before that? The 1-2. 2-2.
You're talking about the Red Sox. The oil can boy, they've got about 9 complete games now. Of course, in the All-Star game in Minnesota, July 16th. Might have gas and oil starting that baby, huh? Oil can Boyd against
White,
20-year-old from the Mets.
What was the can's comment? Good. I hope we do face each other.
Yeah.
I'll show him how to pitch. I don't think Gooden needs many lessons. Through the hole for a base hit for Guillen, a one-out single.
And before the ball game, Luis Salazar came to us and said, now don't forget, it's Guillen. Joe Torre's now doing some television work for the California Angels and also done a little for NBC. He said, all the years I've managed, and he was there a bunch, of course, the Mets and the Manny, I've learned so much this season already through spring training, watching Dean Mock handle the pitching staff, strategic moves.
Guillen bluffs the go. Salazar takes the ball. Gene Mauck's tenure of 23 years as a major league manager. Phillies, Twins, Expos, second time around with the Angels. Without a pennant is the longest stretch of managing without winning a pennant in major league history. Did win a division title with the Angels in 82.
Rich shading his eyes and battling.
And can't find it. It drops. It's the third time it's happened. Safe at second base. What a piece of base running by Guillen. He was in no man's land with just one out. Mike Brown thought that Rick had it. He gave up on it and then couldn't recover in time. Benitez had a hold. Guillen close. And Guillen, by getting to second base, really did some nice base running. Brown came in, then couldn't get there in time.
Scored as a single, obviously, for Salazar. It happened to Desense on a foul ball. Hewlett and Guillen on a pop-up, which they were able to turn into a fourth play, but this time
played so much winter baseball against such great competition. And Tom Seaver talked about this. He said they tried to move him around defensively. He said, when I pitch, I don't have to move again. He knows right what my stuff is, where I should go. He just showed some outstanding base running instinct, too, not getting forced out.
Rudy Law struck out his first time. 0-1. The White Sox trying to climb back into it. They trail 4-0 as they bat here in the bottom of the third. Two-run homers by Mike Brown and Juan Benitez for the Angels in the second.
It's interesting. I wonder if Joe Nosek, the first base coach, is a great sign stealer. And Roger Craig, there's Nosek, and Roger Craig has always said, he caught the slip finger. The toughest thing about it is trying to conceal it because you've got to jam it between those two fingers. And that last pitch, the forkball, Rudy Law shifted his feet. His left foot went back like he's going to hit that off-speed pitch the opposite way. And they may be calling his forkball at times, maybe from the stretch, not from the windup. That could be Nosek. Maybe he could relay it beforehand to the hitter and say, hey, here's what he does on the forkball. You can pick it up from home plate.
Of course, you're talking now about stealing pitches, but Nosek says when trying to steal signs, the key is to watch the opposing manager, not coaches, because the signs from manager to coach are far less complex than the signs from coach to player.
Why a lot of managers don't give them. You see managers really assign the trainer to give a sign, or a player fired down on the bench.
The bases are loaded. Guillen to third, Salazar to second, and Law to first.
That'll bring a trip out to the mound. Renee's brother, Marcel Latchman. John McNamara would like to have taken this Latchman, Marcel, up to Boston with him, and Gene Mock says, no way. He said, we think so much alike. He's the best pitching coach I've ever been around. Down to that bullpen for the Angels. You got the left-hander Clemens, Mastani Moore down there, Steve Clyburn, a youngster, Luis Sanchez is back, and Doug Corbett, the sinker baller. Nobody's throwing right now.
I was talking to Marcel Latchman about that famous beer commercial he starred in as the aging pitcher down in the minor leagues with the scouts looking for some help in the stretch run. Ran for several years. I asked him who the batter was, the guy he fanned at the end of the commercial. He said he was the only non-athlete in uniform, but they wanted an actor, someone who looked menacing. An actor named Tony King. Hewlett lined out his first time, takes a strike, and Marcel Latchman said, if I could have faced that guy every time, I'd be in the major leagues still. Boy, this guy was a bad hitter. Nice guy, bad hitter.
Look at Hewlett's gone to that crouch. He's hitting the ball in the opposite way a lot better now. To try and pull everything. Hit a few home runs in the minor leagues, using double figures. He said when he came to the big leagues, and he started seeing those breaking balls and more sliders on the outside half of the plate, he said, I knew I had to go the opposite way. Mike Lung helped him with that.
Bases loaded, one out.
Like that.
But it's going to hang up, and it's caught by Brown. A run will score as Guillen tags and comes across.
That pop-up that got in the sun and the wind helped out, but Guillen really is the guy with that very astute base running, getting to second base. It's one out, keeping the rally going. Back to Jen the other day, next inning again, Oakland scored from second base on a wild pitch to win a ball game. Ozzie Guillen, up against him.
Harold Baines had a homer on Tuesday against Oakland, his fifth of the year and his first since late April. He could connect now.
Appeal.
The ball game.
They are going to appeal.
No.
Third base umpire John Hurstek is the safe side. Sensei still having a couple of words with him, saying that he probably left too soon. It's unusual because Mike Brown wasn't even at the lead too soon. Mike Brown, with a 4-run lead, didn't even come home. He just went to second base.
these guys, although it's been a little bit of a home run drought, he still manages to sneak his base hits in. He has such outstanding bat control. I told you, he isn't pulling the ball much anymore. They're really powering him inside and going after him with hard stuff. When he swings at balls above the belt, he's got that blind spot up and in. That's what they're trying to go for.
Second base is Gritch with the flip to Schofield for the force. And Lugo escapes with only one run scored. Tony Kubek back at Comiskey Park. To say the very least, the elements have been a factor. The wind in terms of the long ball, especially the one Benitez hit out in dead center field, and that sun is really making it difficult on the infield.
You get to thinking we're in Wrigley Field on the north side of town instead of White Sox Park. Well, were there 180 home runs hit in this ballpark last year? We talked about how this used to be a great pitcher's park. Last year, more home runs hit here than any other park in the major leagues. Just, and with a wind factor like this, going to have determination the outcome of this game. You're looking better all the time, I'll say that. For an older fella.
Ladies and gentlemen,
on his way up.
This I know is the moment you've all been looking forward to. The fourth and fifth inning. The play-by-play inning devoted to Mr. Tony Kubek. Proceed.
Mike Brown's already got a two-run home run into the teeth of a win off the upper deck. Tim Lowler, who has struck out three, walked two. First pitch strike to Brown. Angels have had a lot of injuries this year. Is out. Jeff Zahn still out. Ken Forsh had elbow surgery after battling back last year with a shoulder problem. Rick Burleson re-injured his shoulder in the offseason. Left field, another deep one, but not deep enough. This is the wind will kill as Rudy Law goes back to the track and left center field. One out. You see why some teams are interested in Mike Brown. Gary Pettis, one of the most exciting players in the game. I can't recall when I've seen a center fielder or an outfielder work harder on his defense than this guy. He's out there practicing shoestring catches in batting practice, backhanded catches and throwing.
The jump he gets on a ball is at times astounding. The ball will leave the batter, you swear it's a base hit, and he turns it into what looks like a routine catch.
2-1, Cincinnati over Atlanta, that ball game in the fifth. One ball, no strikes, one out. California four. Saw the White Sox run, we're at the top of the fourth.
You may have heard Reggie's comment about Pettis. He said, I play with simply the best center fielder in baseball. He plays right center, left center, short center, and another foot or two over the fence. And Doug DeSense, who was a teammate of Paul Blair's for a number of seasons, compares the youngster favorably to Blair, who might have been the best defensive center fielder of his generation.
Pettis spent seven seasons in the minor leagues. He's 27 years of age. He was sent by the Angels and Dean Mock to the Harry Walker School of Hitting down in Alabama. Bruce Stubing went along with him. That's one of the reasons why. Overswinging. Worked especially from the left side with Pettis. All you got to do is put the ball in play. And Dean Mock has finally convinced him that, hey, look, base on balls is just like a hit to get on. He's taking some base on balls. Two balls, two strikes, one out. Pettis with an infield single. Scored a run in the second.
We may have a chance, Tony, later in the telecast to show you an incredible sequence in a game at Anaheim against the Rangers a couple weeks ago. Pettis was on first base. Schofield grounded out. He went from first to third on the ground out, then noticed that home plate had been left unattended, and Moose Stubing gave him a little nudge, the third base coach. He said, come on, go ahead. They're not covering the plate. And he just raced home and came all the way around from first, in effect, on an infield out.
He has stolen base, home plate twice on that hard swing. He strained something in his hand, left hand it appeared. Sitting on the bench for the Angels, Rodney Carew has stolen home plate 17 times. Did a lot of that when Billy Martin was there with the Minnesota Twins. 2-2, one out. Puts it on the fist, he does. Off balance, throw to Walker's two out. Did a lot of intense scouting on DeJan before they made the trade. They sent Lamar Hoyt over. He was a short stop. that maybe his arm would not be strong enough to play short. Well, he's this. He has the strongest arm among shortstops, and yet he gets the ball over the first base probably quicker than anybody else. So it isn't always arm strength. Quickness of the arm, how hard to charge the ball. Guillen just did that. He charged it very well. Juan Benitez, 2-for-2. He continues his red-hot streak. A single in the first and a two-run home run in the second. Windblown home run in right center. Lauer. Changeup. He goes 2-0. Well, they say that in June, their series aren't that important, but you see Fisk and Boone, two 37-year-olds, catch a day game after night game. That'll show how important this series is to the managers. Mock, look at the wind get that one. Pushes Harold Baines not only around in circles, but back to the warning track on a weak swing, and the ball carries about 270 feet. Three up, three down inning for Tim Lauer, but a little thrill in there. We'll go to the bottom of the fourth. 4-1, Angels. Urbano Lugo takes the mound, bottom of the fourth. Angels with a 4-1 lead over the Chicago White Sox. Greg Walker struck out in the second. Carlton Fisk and then Ron Kittle. Lugo has three strikeouts. He's walked one. Bobby Gretsch, he is so much fun to watch play as he sees that forkball side. Down by Boone. You see him when the pitch leaves the pitcher's hand, not before. He's 3-4 steps to his left against the left-handed hitter. He's already caught that bullet off the bat of Kittle. Fastball away, or maybe even a slider. He's moving to his right. What he has lost, his defensive agility and legs, he's made up with smart.
Carlton Fisk, Tony, has hit 238 home runs as a catcher. That's fourth on the all-time list for catchers, just four behind Roy Campanella. Yogi Berra is second, and Johnny Bench is first.
Fastball strike to Fisk. Johnny Bench, future Hall of Famer. Yogi and Campy already there. Here's where Pudge Fisk stands in the home run derby. Young catchers. He had to sensei back with one strike. He's going to bunt. He'll do that 8-10 times a year. 1-1.
Of course, the historians in the audience might note that the figures there don't match up with the lifetime totals of Bench or Berra, but those are only home runs hit while playing the catcher's position. And Yogi, of course, played some outfield and might have had some as a pinch hitter, as did Bench.
Two balls, one strike. Into spring training about 220-225, he jammed him. Fastball ran on his fist, got the ball in his kitchen. Vicente gets the easy line drive, two out. I'm going to get you to start doing this plyometric, fill up your strength. Imagine that ball you hit off Bob Gibson in St. Louis last year, where that ball might have gone if you'd have been in the strength and power training and plyometrics.
I don't think there's any doubt it would have been in the bleachers. As it was on the warning track, wasn't it?
Don't ever step in the batter's box. It's Bob Gibson again. Two outs, Ron Kittle. The usual double play last time up that he hit into. One ball. The barrister, along with a little genius. Boy, he is. He mocks. You have managers like Dick Williams, now with San Diego Padres, and the coach under him, Don Zimmer, on. And every one of them will tell you that he is their mentor. Gene Mock. Talk about not winning pennants. A lot of that is because he never had very good teams. The pitching staff especially. In fact, this may be one of the best pitching staffs he's had in a long time that he's building up right now.
Well, think of the teams he had. He did have some good ones in there, obviously, the Phillies of the mid-60s, and the Angels in the early 80s, but he had the Phils of the early 60s, and they were putrid. The expansion Expos, the Twins weren't very good most of the time he was there.
Fastball, belt high, and look at everybody coming over. Five guys trying to battle and win the setting. Kittle is going to be safe. Nobody on third.
fielder, center fielder, second baseman, shortstop, and third baseman, all after a short pop into sudden wind. And Kittle, to the base set, very, very alertly, runs hard from home plate to first. Look at this. Pettis finally gets it. Lugo taking it. If Lugo knew how to make a tag, he's got him dead. But he wasn't sure how to make the tag. Only time the pitchers ever get chances to tag is on that wild pitch, a short pass ball at home plate.
That is the fourth routine pop that's dropped safely in this game.
Happened at the Cincinnati in foul territory. Fritz at second base. This one right here. So with two outs, the White Sox have Kittle with a double down on second base. Darryl Boston, third strikeout victim in the third, and Ivana Lugo.
Tony, when you played here, do you remember the sun on afternoon ball games being that tough at Comiskey?
No. I think the sun was obviously that advantageous pattern.
But I would think
we got stupid to death. But the wind is so different here now. That wind, with this park barn closed, with that scoreboard in center field, the electronic scoreboard, the $1 million one that Beck put in there, it has changed the wind current. The worst I've ever played in World Series, of course, San Francisco, out in Candlestick Park. We played those day games out there with a high sky, cloudless, the wind swooped over those hills. It should be almost a day like this. One ball, one strike, two outs. Kittle's at second. What a fourth ball. Wow. One little angel, a wispy cloud right in the center of your screen. That isn't going to help much. Even with the sunglasses, eyes blackened. Your high sky. One ball, two strikes, two outs. Darryl Boston. Seen a hitter complain yet that they think Lugo is doctoring the baseball. One and two. Fastball runs away out of the strike zone. Two balls, two strikes, two outs.
How about the sunfield in left at Yankee Stadium when it got into September and the World Series in October?
Not as bad now because that haze, there's Kittle at second, that haze used to collect. So that high triple deck, not only had the sun, didn't have much wind. This low with a fourth ball, and we go full, 3-2. If you put the sunglasses down too soon, you'd lose it. You put them down too late, it'd be in the sun. Bring the fall to stadium, and the same with Fenway Park. Right field out there. Babe Ruth refused to play right field in Fenway, left field Yankee Stadium. 3-2. He went fourth ball on a full count to Darryl Boston after four here at Comiskey Park. 4-1, California. We'll be right back after these messages from your local station.
Tony Kubek, fortunately, working this next inning play-by-play, giving me an opportunity to finish up this very tasty Comiskey Park hot dog. Comiskey, in addition to being one of the grand old parks, is one of the leaders in terms of quality of concessions, a wide variety of tasty treats, including the bratwurst.
Get off the hot dogs and let's talk about Ben and Joe and Joe Morgan and Jay Randolph and all these guys doing another game. Yankees-Tigers, only the first game of a doubleheader, folks. This game's gone on a long time, which is typical of games in the American League and typical of White Sox games. Tim Lauer. He's got a 4-1 ball game. California Angels lead it. Nick Schofield. Ryan Downey. Doug DeCinse. Two balls, no strikes. You are truly a versatile performer. I've seen you on the Letterman show. I've seen you a little wacky, zany bit in pregame shows. And I'm not talking about NFL 85. A lot of straight stuff. But to eat a hot dog and read a promo, you're an amazing young man. 2-1.
Thank you so much.
I don't know how many years they have to keep calling you an up-and-coming young man.
You could stop now if you'd like.
3-1 to Schofield. You know, flied out and struck out.
Luckily for you, you reside in Milwaukee or nearby.
can get over to County Stadium and get the single best ballpark item anywhere, that bratwurst with the secret sauce.
Full count now to Schofield. Marco put a lot of take signs out. I don't think there's any manager in the game that feeds more signals to his coaches, at least shooting at third primarily, than Gene Mock. He likes pitchers to pitch a lot. Popped up 3-2. They're all converging again. Will anybody get it? Hewlett got it. He was looking away from the sun. Say one thing. This is one of those days where base runners don't loaf. They run hard because they might have a double that's happened already. While we have a break with one down, right now let's go for a report to New York.
All right, Tony, in Cincinnati, Bob Horner, so much a key for the Braves, has hit his second home run of the day. Over the wall in left, a solo home run. Third time this year, Horner has hit two in a game. 2-2, they're tied in the seventh. Back to Tony and the versatile up-and-coming young announcer, Bob Costas.
What did he say? Bob Costas, Tony Kubek, back here at Comiskey Park, Chicago. Angels leading over the White Sox 4-1. Tim Lawler now to Brian Downey. He was 2-for-2 after that horrendous slump. A single to left and a double to left. One ball, one strike. Not going to make it out of here as Darryl Boston puts the glasses down for the second out. Now it's the sixth thing.
Now, Tony, speaking of County Stadium in Milwaukee, can you answer something for me? I haven't been there this year. They tell me that Bernie Brewer is no more.
Bernie Brewer, not deceased, folks, but they put this beautiful speaker system out just beyond the center field fence. Bernie, after every Brewer home run, he used to submerge himself with his lederhosen and a what looked like a mug of beer.
I used to love that little guy sliding down into his mug.
I wonder if the motives of the great owner, Bud Selig, did they stop hitting home runs? They're less than 100 last year after that big home run year where they played the Cardinals in the World Series. I haven't hit as many. He said, Bernie, they're paying you too much money for sitting there. One ball.
Bernie's got a sublet now from his buddy Nakahoma in Atlanta. Gave him a little room in the back of the teepee. Just until he catches on with somebody else.
Two balls, no strike to Vicente. Another one of the Angels has got to stay healthy. Had those recurrent back problems you talked about. Was down this year with some spasms. Gene Mock has had to change his lineups around. Play a lot of people in different positions. Three balls, no strike. See now, with the cleanup hitter DeCinte 3-0, Gene Mock will let him hit. Unlike Schofield, who was 3-1 leading off this inning, he looked like he had the takeout. La Russa, already yelled out, put something out. He may be hitting, and he was, but it's ball four. So Reggie Jackson will step in with two outs, man on first base.
You know, Mock's comment about Jackson earlier this year was an interesting one, and perhaps designed to work on Reggie's mind a little bit and get him psyched up for what could be a run at the division title. Mock said, forget about all the individual numbers. Reggie Jackson will be remembered as a great team player. Look at the success of the teams he's been on. And I'm convinced, by the way, he has put out for me when I've managed him with the Angels, said Mock, that the guy is a good team player.
It is not coincidental. Success follows him around, or the success of his team. Last year, home runs for the 17th. Talking about the number one draft choice this year, Bo Jackson, who may be choosing football. And he said, man, they already got him in the Hall of Fame. They're talking about a 44-man. What a cut he had. He had a pitch. He had sprained his ankle. He corkscrewed into the ground when he saw that pitch up and in. And got a little twinge in the right ankle after a very hard swing.
Yeah, the Angels took Bo Jackson out of Auburn. Ashburn, the Heisman Trophy candidate, running back, who says that he hasn't decided between baseball and football for a professional career. They took him in the 20th round because people assume he's going to play football.
One strike on Reggie with two outs. He got it. Reggie's right foot still bothering him considerably after he strided that last time, and Lala made a perfect pitch right down to the lower end. Two strikes. Reggie has struck out and he walked in the third. Watch his reaction if we see it after his right foot hits the ground. When he had that hard swing on the first strike, he may have twisted something. Two strikes, two outs. 4-1, California Legion. One ball, two strikes. Reggie was saying he should be. He said they gave a press release on Jackson, Bo Jackson, when they drafted him, the Angels, that is bigger than all of my records in the book. And the media guy, he said, they're talking about him running a 6-1-60. He said, I don't believe it. He said, I'm a skeptic. Talk about him. He's going to have 40 home runs before he's ever played a professional game and steal 40 bases. And I've heard our reports are great on him. College guys like Travis Williams before, former great football player and punt and kickoff return. He said, he didn't run that fast. Good slider. Gets Reggie Jackson. So Lauer registers strikeout number 4. The Cincinnati's fan, and we go to the bottom of the fifth. Angels 4, White Sox 1. Ozzie DeGent, Luis Salazar, Rudy Law. The three hitters in the fifth to face for Otto Lugo. We now got the official report from some of our Chicago crew, Ken Harvey, Bruce Berquist, who say these are the worst conditions they've seen. His son and winning this ballpark. They've done a lot of games. DeGen will be held to a single. He jumps on Lugo. Looked like a fork ball up in the strike zone. Rifles it to right field. So he's on. White Sox trying to come back. The three-run deficit. So one Venezuela gets to hit off another. Lugo, now another one steps in. Luis Salazar. Salazar is single to right. DeGen now 2-for-2 with a run scored. Ball one. Mike Lums is trying to eliminate that little bit of an uppercut that Salazar has. He's vulnerable to pitches up and down high or above. Into the left field. DeGen will hit for third. Downey has the ball. Leland is sending him on. Here comes the relay. He is safe. Not a very graceful slide by DeGen. And he really hustled off first base. And Jimmy Leland, even down by three runs at that time, knew the strength of Downey's arm and kept him coming. Very, very aggressive third base coaching by Jimmy Leland. It is 4-2. By Salazar, so DeGen and Salazar, the 8-9 hitters, off their fellow countrymen Lugo, are 4-for-4. Schofield's throw is a good one, a one hopper to Boone, and I think that DeGen caught the right leg of Boone, and that's what caused him to stumble as he went past. But you could tell that even a perfect throw from Schofield, and it was close to that, was not going to get DeGen. Tried to block the plate, but then had to move off a little bit to go after the baseball, and he then took a stumble. So with Rudy Law, the hitter waiting on by, Marcel Latsin makes his third trip out to the mound to talk to Lugo and Bob Boone. Law has struck out and walked. Still nobody out in the bottom of the fifth. Benitez at first in case Law tries to drop down a butt and beat it out. Even though it's two runs down, he's going to be sacrificing, of course, but he's got to try to get the ball down to the right side. Base hit to the right side. Make it out right side instead of left. By the way, Charlie Lau designed that pitch
situational hitting field. Leaving now in batting practice, we look at the defensive alignment and since they are tight. Every day these White Sox under the supervision of Mike Love, they have a routine. Breaking ball off the glove of Boone. 2-0. They get up to the plate and they first take the first swing and they'll hit a ground ball. Look, there's a man on third and the infield's back to score the run. Bandy will take the ball and loft it to the outfield on swing number two. Five score runners from third and less than two outs. Then they'll pull the ball to the right side, trying to advance the run to third. And they'll swing for themselves. See, they're funding it all out. 2-0. Popped up. Vicente with the glasses down, the glove up. Looks like he's looking through the webbing of his glove. He's got that ace webbing to try and use the glasses and also shade the shot. Boy, it is tough.
I was going to say, if you talk about situational hitting,
Pat Clemens, the left-hander,
used him last night. Steve Clyburn is also up as we widen out. Pick him up. Clyburn, the right-hander. If you were practicing situational hitting today, you'd have guys hitting fungos, just practicing pop-ups. That's the best offense, because most of them have dropped today.
Tim Hewlett, he lined out.
Cruz was hurt. This guy was red hot in his place. Hitting around 350 for a while.
Well, Cruz had the off-season knee surgery. Maybe he's back on one of our games. During the first phase, he damaged it again. Back on the disabled list. Hewlett has somewhat won a job. He may not cover the ground at second base of Cruz, and of course isn't the acrobat like Cruz, but offensively adds a little punch. The runner at second base is Salazar. At the bottom of the fifth, 4-2, California Legion. He then led off with a single to right. Salazar, right for the double. Left field corner, he then scoring from first. Rudy Law popped out. Look at this guy. You want to see a pair of hands? He knocks it down. Will he get it? Benitez couldn't get it out. Boy, that ball's with a wicked hop. It is very thick grass here. We talked about Roger Boster, the third generation groundskeeper here. A consultant with the Cleveland Indians. Marshall Bossard, his predecessor here. So, a base hit. Runners on first and second. One out. Carroll Baines, 0 for 2 in the game. Good off-speed hit. The fork ball had him away. There are your base runners.
It seems to me that one of the keys to Lugo's effectiveness with the forkball is that he can throw it at more than one speed. He can throw it as an off-speed pitch, and he can throw a harder version.
Well, the one that's the hard version is the one that some teams suspect is illegal. One strike to Bane. All fastball. Boy, he saw it was coming. It was belt high, inside part of the plate, and he was setting on a fastball, and it was a little late. Good pitch by Lugo and Boone, though. They want to run the ball in on his fifth. Now, Lugo, way ahead, no ball, two strikes. That was a harder one up in the strike zone. It was one ball, two strikes. Lugo wants a different ball. Tony La Russa and the coaching staff had a tape of Lugo's last ball game out in California. And you see the two runners once again. Salazar at second, Hewlett at first. And they were looking when he went off the mound, and Lisa Gray, we can't see him. If he does got to a pitch, he said, we can't find him. This time he goes to his mouth is when he's off the dirt surface. Fouled off, out of play. Baines way late. Now he's still at 1-2. So we've watched him when he goes into his glove. We've watched him when he touches the back of his cap. There, foreign substance on his head. He said, we don't think he's throwing it. Now Boone, to get it straight. Head of the count to Harold Baines. What they want to do. Bob Boone's dad, Ray, played for the White Sox briefly in 59, but he wasn't there when they won the pennant. In the middle of that year, he went to the Milwaukee Braves. The Braves played the Dodgers in the playoff game. Boone said, I was back for it for one game. Los Angeles Coliseum. But I did a lot of running around this ballpark when I was growing up.
One ball, two strikes, one out. 4-2, California over the White Sox.
2-2. Ray and Bob Boone, part of the answer to an intriguing trivia question. Only four father-son Major League combinations have each played in a World Series. Obviously, there have been dozens and dozens of fathers and sons who have played in the Major League, but only four have each been series participants.
J.B. Ash, what a fan. Get the win, gets it. It's deep to center field. Pettis, an acrobat. Back to the fence. He got it. The wind blew it, and I don't know if it was out of the ballpark, but Pettis does this as a routine. He is unbelievable. He got turned around by the wind, battling the sun. He goes up to about a 7.5-foot fence.
They both play shallow. The wind is tough, and it very well might have been over the fence. Salazar made a bad play, I think, over at second base, because had the ball hit off the fence and been in play, he could have scored from second, so he should have been back there to tag, and he wasn't.
Walker! As Kent Kaiser says, it's a fair ball, so it'll be the knee tag unassisted. A scare thrown at Diego Van Lugo by Dave, but Pettis was brilliant again. Your score after five.
A look at the defensive artistry of Gary Pettis robbing Harold Baines of what would at least have been a game-tying extra base hit and might have been a three-run homer to put them in front. Now look at Pettis, the base runner. He's on first base in this game against Texas. Schofield grounds to Buddy Bell. All the way to third goes Pettis. He beats the throw. Now Curtis Wilkerson has the ball. Now watch Moose Steuben, the third base coach. He doesn't want to give his plan away. He's nudging. Gary, go, go.
Go get him.
Now Don Swart realizes that home plate is uncovered. He gets there too late. And all the way around from first on a ground out comes Gary Pettis. But Steuben was something to watch. He didn't want to make it too obvious. He just snuck up and said, hey, listen, Gary, why don't you just head on down the line there? I don't think they're watching.
Yes. Technically, if the umpire sees that, you're not supposed to be able to touch that. Was it Taylor with the Cardinals?
2 years back.
He assisted. He helped the guy get to his feet. Barely touched him. There's Gary Pettis. And D-Mock has an appreciation. Not only for a run scored, but a run saved. And there were a couple saves right there by Pettis.
Rich leads it off in the sixth against Lawler and takes high. The Angels have six hits against Lawler. Sox have the same number off Lugo, but Lawler hasn't permitted a hit since the second inning. And the White Sox have begun to get to Lugo. 2-0.
You figure Lawler hasn't hit that badly. You got a win like this, you're going to get behind a few more hitters. That slider's a little bit more difficult to control, trying to put the spin on it. The hand dries off, but you pitch a little more carefully with this win. Enriquez has already had the wind blown home run. It was a routine fly ball in most days.
3-0 to Grish. While he steps out, we'll tell you this telecast is presented by authority of Major League Baseball. It may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form without the express written consent of Major League Baseball. He walks him on four pitches to open the sixth. Second time Grish has received the base on balls today.
One time, Lawler, the reliever, and that's of course Tony Lewis from Dave Duncan. They had similar plans to Lawler. He wanted that extra left hander in the bullpen, and Lowler's figuring out of it, but sometimes the kid hasn't had the stamina to go more than 5 or 6 innings. Yeah, and White Sox made it back in this ballgame. Not going to let Lawler go a whole lot longer.
As Tony mentioned, he's hitting out of that open stance now and feels he's seeing the ball a lot better as a result.
He may be bunny right here. He mocked the last time around. And he won the West, had an inning on the 8-9 spot. He's very productive. Lawler trying to find something out. See if the base runner, but more so, Boone will pick something off, whether it's a bunt, hit and run, or if he's hitting away. He may try to pat his leading butt right now.
He squares, and
a good bunt. Whoa, he out at first and barely so. Walker had a thought for a moment about letting it go foul, and then he realized, I'd better grab this if I'm going to have any play at all. That thick grass slowed it down and started trickling, but Walker had to make a last-minute judgment call. Said, I better get one or I may not get any. And then almost flips it away. Nice play by Hewlett covered. So this will bring up Mike Brown. So do you walk in to get the pennant? First base open. Fisk and Lauer had a talk about it.
I don't know if you want to do that this early in the ballgame. Maybe open up the gate for a big inning.
Now you got Pettis, who is not going to hit the double play, but he's more likely to hit the double play from the right side. You got a strikeout possibility, but then you'd have Benitez. You at least set force out, offer the possibility of a double play. Like yesterday, the Rooster walked quick to get to Reggie. Just the out, Reggie to get the grip, and Grip hit 720 against the Lancer. That's what it was.
Ball one to Brown. Lawler might want to be careful with him for other reasons. Brown has hit a long home run off of him and then fly to deep left. Lawler began his professional career with the Yanks, then on to the Padres in a deal, and then this offseason from San Diego to Chicago. The 1-0. A little bit off it, 1-1. Top of the sixth. California leads at 4-2. They got four in the second on two-run homers by Brown and Benitez. The White Sox got one in the third and one in the fifth. They might have had a lot more was it not for a great catch by Gary Pettis. Blocked by Fisk at 2-1.
So we were talking about Dr. Clausen, the chiropractor, who worked so hard all last winter with Fisk. And he said, it wasn't just strength and flexibility. He said, it was a lot of other things. He said, if you worked all winter long, agility drills with his footwork, and he's blocking pitches better than he ever has, or as good as he was when he was a kid, and he's throwing a lot better. So it wasn't just physical training, so to speak. A lot of baseball techniques. In fact, Tony Reinsdorf, the White Sox hitter, one of them is moving Alvin Neal out here. He went to the Chicago Bulls, the CEOs, the basketball, and the White Sox, the higher permanently.
2-1, up and in, 3-1. Recently returned from a trip to Japan. He was actually there in part with one of his wrestling promotions. And he also took the opportunity to observe the Japanese minor league system. See if there were any ideas he could incorporate here in the States. He walked in.
Eddie, a couple of years ago, he said that they started to get rid of completely, as I understood his quote, completely rid of stuff of the minor leagues. They're too costly. That players can come in and see the college run, which more and more are coming from.
And then this week in the sporting news, Leonard Coppett, who was always among the more provocative sports writers, suggests that baseball should simply centralize the minor leagues. And until AAA, everybody should just be under control of Major League Baseball in general, and then you would draft players from the pool and have about 40 or so under your control in the minor leagues, but you'd centralize the cost. And the scouts would work for baseball, the coaches would work for baseball, rather than for your team. And baseball could save a lot of money that way.
Yeah. Sooner or later, the backbone of any organization is your farm system. I think that's why the Blue Jays ran so rapidly late in their career to become contenders last year. Gillick, that scout, good managers, farm systems, pitching coaches.
With two on and one out. Swings on the first one. It's down the right side and apparently out of play as it falls safely. Well, Leonard Coppett said that in his article. He anticipated objections from those organizations that have been traditionally strong in the farm system, the Dodgers, the Orioles, the Blue Jays might be joining that group. That's an idea, and he threw it out on the table. Whereupon it will probably be flung right back in his face.
Yeah, this ball game's ready in the sixth inning. Just a little over 2 hours old.
You know, they move at a brisk pace these days.
Don't then have patience. We're going to try to get a Yanks here for the second game of our doubleheader. May take a while. We'll be there.
The 0-1. Foul back. Talk about long games. In the minors, they finally completed that Syracuse-Pawtucket game last night. They had suspended it after about the 20th inning. It wound up going 27 innings. And Pawtucket won it 3-1. Pawtucket was involved in a 33-inning game in 1981 against Rochester. Now the 0-2 defender. Could be two even with Pettis' speed. There's one. And two. Started in the Chicago six. The White Sox had Lugo on the rope in the bottom of the fifth, and Pettis bailed him out with a great catch in dead center. Hitting ball one.
They want to keep Fisk off the plate. Like there, he hit some really great sliders low and away. And breaking balls, likes to get the arm out, reach out for the pitch, dives into the ball. That's why they want to move him off. That's why he hit so much.
Sends the curveball into left field. Downing started back, now comes in and has it.
See, that's an interesting call you made about that. It's hard to tell from up here, but his forkball, when he changes speed sometimes, as Dave Smith with that Houston Astros. Sometimes that forkball has such a big dowel and break and say, that's a piece of the curveball. I can't always tell from up here either, even watching the TV monitor. That downward action, but it tumbles off the table.
I'll tell you, if you can't tell, I can't tell. Probably just a guess.
Well, we're going to have John Filipelli, our producer, Harry Carter, director, going to center field, looking at his glove for him. What are you doing? See him stick that ball between those two fingers. See the cork ball action.
Kittle has twice hit pop-up that have been lost in the sun and wind. One was turned into a force play. Another became a fluke double. Benitez will try and handle this one and does and fouls out. So that'll bring up Darryl Boston. Now we were talking about that amazing game against Syracuse and Pawtucket. It went 27 innings. The major league record for a game is 26 innings in terms of innings played, not time elapsed. 26 innings back in 1920. Brooklyn and Boston played to a 1-1 tie, and they played the game in about 4 hours. In May of last year here at Comiskey Park, the Brewers and White Sox played a 25-inning game, eventually won by Chicago on a Harold Baines homer. So one inning less, and it took twice as long. It took 8 hours to play that game.
Harold Baines finished that one off.
Homer off Chuck Porter. 14 pitchers were used in the Brewers-White Sox game that went 25 innings. Back in 1920, a bygone era. Both pitchers went the distance. Joe Oster for the Boston Braves and Leon Fedor for the Brooklyn Dodgers. Each pitched the whole 26 innings in a 1-1 tie.
He can run.
Rich gets Boston. So Lugo settles down and retires the White Sox in order in the sixth. We'll be right back after these messages from your local station. Costas and Tony Kubek at Comiskey Park in Chicago, and as always, we'll pick a light beer from Miller's player of the game at the conclusion of the ball game.
So far, the biggest factor in this ball game, aside from Mike Brown's legit home run, obviously we have to bet he's going to come to win. That pays scrambling, doesn't it?
In that case, we'll give the award to Willard Scott. Benitez, Schofield, and Downing in the seventh. As his 2-for-3. Strike one to him.
He's not reaching.
Go ahead, Tony.
He's not quite the same cross
to get going sometime. In fact, last year when Bobby Gripp started hitting, he finally found a stance. He's like kind of a man of a thousand stances. Gripp, he finally copied Benitez crouch, and he's looking over that left shoulder. Called it Benitez stance. Not quite as extreme now. See debris on the field, right field. Larry Barnett calls for time.
One of those extremely flattering hats.
Yeah.
All dignified citizens favor on a day like this. Benitez, an intriguing pitching pairing tomorrow. Young Bruce Tanner for the White Sox, and Mike Witt, he's only 5-6, but as you know, authored a perfect game on the last day of the season in 1984, and is capable of throwing those low-hit games. He'll go for the Angels.
Got a few future Hall of Famers in the ballpark today, aside from Reggie. Tommy John, of course, has been let go. He certainly has a chance. John's going to be a car analyst, I believe. Five games short of the magic number 300. Carew
could be the third hit for Benitez, and it is. Extra bases as it rolls near the 401 sign. At least a double, and he wants three. A leadoff triple for Benitez.
I think the outfield has gotten tired. They could do a lot of splitting and infield pop-ups trying to help out. Ball hit the grass, rolled a little bit to the wall. He continues hot, doesn't he?
Wouldn't want to touch him. You might change your finger. 3-4 today, 4-5 last night. He's got to be flirting with 450 for the month.
People forget how good an outfielder Benitez was. He won a gold glove in the outfield and played all those positions this year. Sometimes they thought he was going to be shortstop for the Red Sox. Infield's going to come in. Yeah, a little less than halfway on the left side. Out for a squeeze play, folks. You never know with D-Mock. You may see a pitch out like this.
Angels lead 4-2. Nothing on this one, and it's high for a ball.
We're going to have to be alive. Moose Stubbe, giving a side. You give a side to the hitter. Schofield. And many will probably give a verbal side or just walk up to the third baseman and whisper in his ear whether he's going or not.
Different ways
that a fish and a Lauer can handle it. There's Moose shooting, the third baseman can handle it. Some teams do it one way. Right on him, you have to knock the hitter down to run his cutter. No matter what you call it, a curve or an off-speed pitch, you knock to a fastball, knock him down. Some teams, they just go with the pitch that you threw, because if you cross up your pitcher that way, you get a miscommunication.
Concerned with the possibility of what Moss might have on here. Lawler has fallen behind Schofield 3-0. There's Moss, and we asked him, he's a great bench jockey he's ever encountered work. He gave us a list of his top bench jockeys. You don't have those guys around, at least not as many as you did some years ago in baseball. That's right.
But they've actually got tonight. I need to construct the upper video. I need the poster. He was a great everywhere. Great manager. Great shortstop years ago, I guess. Don Newcomb, just a surprise. Dick Williams, but he I knew about. Still looks pretty good.
3-1. A called strike, and the count is full. Just bluffing to throw down the third.
You know, Deep Rock has got all those young pitchers in spring training this year. He said, you know, I'm going with the rookies. They have talent. He said, another thing, it's easier for a rookie to break in now because there is less bench jockey. He said, they used to ride a pitcher to death from the bench, and somebody could rattle so a young pitcher would just be pushed back to the minor leagues. He said, not anymore.
Off down the right side. Walker might have room, but the wind's taking it away. He makes the catch, and Benitez tags, but is not coming home. It's just 5-6, and he can't find it, but there to back it up is Lawler.
With everybody chasing that ball on the right side, Lawler was backing up the plate. I think he can try to the shortstop position to come and get in the cutoff position. I think the throw is offline, but he couldn't get there quickly enough. Walker just lobbed the ball and almost got away. Come to win once again.
the first baseman. Why, Jay Reinsdorf is hiring the meal and bringing you from the west to Chicago. Still got the possibility with Dowdy up. Please play, although with him, you're more likely to get the sack fly.
What sort of things would they say to you from the bench? Things that are mentionable on the air.
What dumb pull-out to start with? Me.
You know, a man who has a high regard for his mother is all right with me, Tony. I've always felt this way.
Infield still in.
Benitez led off with a triple. He's there with one out. And he's coming home on this one. Rudy Law back. He may have misjudged it. Leaps to make the catch. And Benitez trots home.
So Dowdy is shallow. He didn't get a hit that time. He's coming out of the slump. He just crushed the ball another time. It almost took off, and that's what happened. It directly at Law. Almost took off over his head. Nice recovery. Makes a nice play.
So credit Downing with a sacrifice fly. And the Angels are in front by three at 5-2. Now that was the inspired bench shopping that you're talking about. When I was playing sandlot ball and then Little League and in high school, there was always this patter that our coaches assured us was real big league style. You swing like a rusty goose.
Yeah.
No better, no better. You own them, you own them. And we'd be losing 23-2, and some guy who had already hit three homers had come up. Our pitcher could barely reach home plate. You own them, babe. Hum, babe. No better.
Yeah, but you were great at the dairy queen afterwards. Oh, an ice cream cone?
Absolutely. 1-1 to DeCente. The mother wears army shoes is always effective. Boy, did that rattle, guys. They fell apart. Two outs, nobody aboard. And 2-1 to DeCente. A run is home in the California 7th. They lead it 5-2.
Tony La Russa. Protege. Hey, Marriott. You boys city down in Tampa. Al Lopez.
Including recently, Mantle and DiMaggio.
They feed both of them.
And like Pete Rose, you cannot slip a statistic by Reggie. Present or past. He's talking about the Mize hitting 40-plus home runs. The Mize was a coach for him when Reggie was a kid with the Oakland A's. Exactly how many strikeouts he had. 36 one year when he'd over 40 home runs. He's in that big ballpark in the Oakland Stadium. Lawler's to the point now in this ballgame with a lot of pitches thrown where I don't think he wants to, nor he dare ought to, hang a slider to Reggie. Wind blown out to right field.
Reggie hasn't put one in play yet today. He's walked once and struck out twice. Every time he stands, he extends his own major league record. In that dubious category, he's still hobbling around, Tony.
Driving this lady in a high swing, a one-down, no-strike kick last time up, and twisted that right ankle, we think. He's got that flair for hitting with men on base. You know, you cannot take that away from this man.
There have been a few players, logically, who were greater than Jackson in his era, but there has been none more dynamic. One and two.
Wicked, wicked breaking ball from Lowry. Atlanta-Cincinnati, that ball game in the ninth inning. Tied at three.
Murphy's got a homer in that game, right? 18 for him. He moves past Kingman for the Major League lead. Kong leads the AL with 17. Bernanski and Fisk each have 16.
Reggie will really cut the swing down on. Usually guys try to hit the ball to the left field or up the middle. Reggie's an unusual defensive alignment. There's some team pitches the left hander today, but they used to pull Reggie's spot straight out to pull. Rudy Laws came down the left field line for him. So the scouting for Clark Johnson. Trying to make a comeback as a pitcher. There's a lot of advanced scouting for him, as is Mike Squires now. They see Reggie in his left hand. With two strikes, he'd go down that left side. A lot more often than he did years ago.
Smith is 2-2.
You talk about getting through. That breaking ball started right at Jackson. He just buckled away from it. The bigger breaking ball, he hasn't thrown much as many of those today. That's a little short slider. Watch Reggie buckle. Oops. Wow.
Too high with the way the strike zone is interpreted nowadays.
Not a book strike zone anymore.
When you were playing, that was strike three, right?
Good hittable pitch, too. Up in the strike zone, a hanging breaking ball. You know what's happened? With everybody going to the inside protection, only Jerry Nudek is left now. Umpires crouch down and they put their eye level at belt level. Anything above that is the ball. One of the reasons they do it is to protect themselves. They're hiding behind the catcher. Because if you get enough foul balls off your shoulders and exposed parts, you're late great couple talking about that. Why he stuck to the inflated protection. He said, boy, he said, you get a jolt on the arms and stuff, and you start flinching on pitches with the approach to plate when you miss a line. You know, he's got a pretty good strike zone with his eye level.
There's one theory that says that this interpretation of the strike zone, the lower strikes being given to the pitcher and the high strikes, forget about it, actually in a way cuts down on offense because hitters are laying off that high pitch, which you might not hit for that good of an average, but you'll hit a lot of home runs on it.
And I think if you've made a lot more low ball hitters, you've got to go down and get the ball now. Be high a little bit below.
Full count to Reggie.
Many will say that there are more home runs hit off the low pitch than the high pitch. And I think there are more home runs hit off the curveball than the fastball, too, but a lot of times they're hanging. Here we go, breaking ball again. Walker moves behind the runner now. He'll be going 3-2, two out.
And Reggie walks for the second time. Bringing up Grit.
Here comes LaRussa. Seventh walk given up by Lowers. He has thrown a lot of pitches. So with a string of four right-handers set up, Grit, Boone, and Brown, he's going to the right-hander. Looks like the right-hander Dan Spillner coming out. He's been pitching well lately.
So the former Cleveland Indians brought in. Lowers departs. And the reaction to him is mixed from the Chicago.
figures on Dan Stoner, who comes out of the bullpen now for Tony La Russa's White Sox. The Eddies with two outs and two on. And the Angels leading 5-2 in the top half of the seventh.
Stoner had a rough spring and a rough start, but the bullpen's really come along for La Russa. 2 years ago when the White Sox won it, they had close to 50 saves. Dennis Lamp led the team with 15. And Stoner's got an ERA below 3. Nelson puts his below 3. James is just a little over 2. They struggle in other areas. Bannister has struggled off and on. Burns had a good starter struggle. Stevens been the most consistent starter. The ERA just over 3, but he's 7-5.
So Bobby Gritt, who like Jackson, hasn't given the fielders a chance today. He walks in a strikeout. Remember the Gritt line from earlier this year? He was lamenting his fate.
Yeah, he got a bunch of good ones this year.
We'll wait till after this pitch. Just don't hit it, Bobby. Okay, ball one. He said, look, I spent 15 years honing my baseball skills, $110 at a tanning salon, $35 to have my hair styled, and then I'm benched on National Secretary's Day. There is no justice. He went around, 1-1. And you don't argue too much with Big Ken Kaiser.
You might have seen on his left arm, the black band, tribute to the late Bill Frunkel. There it is.
One and two.
Hey, the utility of these two teams scoring runs is showing a little bit more today. Bob mentioned to you what they had done. Two last night's games. Fifth game they played this season, there's been 24 runs scored totally. About 2.5 runs per team per game. But with that wind blown out, and Lala giving up 7 bases on balls, the Eagles might have had about 10 on the board already. Couple times he hit.
Driven to right, Baines almost in his tracks, makes the catch. So they settle for 1 in the top half of the 7th, lead it by a score of 5-2. And here's another edition of Baseball Remembers.
Baseball Remembers. Brought to you by new Old Spice Solid Antiperspirant. It keeps you so much drier, you just might want to switch from your old antiperspirant mid-stick. Dick Green remembers the pride that comes with great play in the World Series.
I've made quite a few, I'd say 5 or 6 plays that I thought that were very good in my 11 years of baseball. And it just happened that I made a couple of them in the World Series that 50 million people saw. We had excellent pitching. That was the key to it made playing second base and made playing shortstop very easy because we knew what pitch was coming and where it was going. That's the only way people in the United States know me as of the member of the World Series, Oakland A's. It wasn't because of Dick Green during the baseball season. And I was very proud.
Number 6, Darryl Sonya, is back with the Angels now after a long time on the sidelines. Substance abuse, as they term it, and seated behind him, Rod Carew, 41 shy of 3,000 lifetime, a 7-time batting titleist. He's been bothered by a bruised foot this year, missed time last year with a pinched nerve in his neck that numbed the fingers on his right hand. The injuries have become more frequent as the years have gone by for Rodney.
330 lifetime batting average. Among active players with over 2,000 bats, that Carew broke the string of 16 consecutive years of getting 10 or better last season. Three of the all-time votes in all-star competition. Guys like Reggie and Rodney and Tom, they're calling by the first names, and they're going to the hall, huh? They're all here today.
Ball one high to Guzan. Of course, it's easier to refer to a guy by one name when it's Reggie or Rodney. His name is Tom or Bill or Bob. This is a little more confusing.
Okay, Tom, terrific. Now you know what I'm talking about.
Guzan bluffing the bunt at 2-0.
A tough man to bunt on. Doug DeCinte. Plays a little bit like Steve Boyer, that tweet
was play shallow and dare you to hit the ball by it. Brooks and Greg Nettles, a little different. They play deeply, and if they go ahead bunt on you, they still take it away from you. A little different style.
For some people, Guzan has brought back memories of Luis Aparicio, but it will take a lot to replace little Louie in the hearts of Chicagoans. One Chicago White Sox fan, a fellow who resides here named Dan Herman, was quick to remind me, as Guzan walked on four pitches, that just as I have been known to tote a Mickey Mantle baseball card around, he keeps the Luis Aparicio card from the 50s in his wallet. Indicative of the theme in which he's held here.
And they've had that tradition of Venezuelan shortstop here before. Luis Aparicio was Chico's hottest gal. And I was thinking, Ozzie Guillen, he's going to be a good little player. I think he's going to have to hit a little more. That's where he suspects, I guess. He doesn't have the physical cues on Louis. He doesn't run as fast, doesn't have the throwing arms. He doesn't have the massive stealing bases. He's part of that is speed and quickness.
I want you to know I accomplished two things with that last reference. I got the obligatory Mickey Mantle mention out of the way. It was getting late in the game, and we don't want a week to go by.
I know you've seen that too. Roger Maris up in Fargo has a benefit golf tournament. It's the second and third annual as now Latsman comes out again. But up in Fargo, really working hard. Got a bunch of celebrities. I know you're going to make it. Mike Stanley's going to be there. And
Whitey Herzog.
Whitey Herzog. Lots of others. John Brody's invited. All kinds of people were invited. Sometimes if I can get out of Toronto in time, I'm going to try and make it too.
Okay, can I play golf with you? I know I can win.
Nope. I want you to stand right next to Mickey when he hits his first drive about 350 and say, Mick, like Tippy Patel said to him one time, saying, Mick, you hit the best drive and I'll hit mine. I'll be able to sit on yours for mine. You'll be able to do that
what
too.
What you want me to say, right? All right. Hugh Clyburn's coming in. Trying to figure out just what is the meaning of all this. We'll be right back. Clyburn is another one of those who escaped the minor leagues under the seven-year rule. Joe Cowley of the Yankees is another example. You're in one team's organization for 7 years. They don't bring you up to the major leagues. You can declare free agency. He spent 7 years in the Pirates organization, never got a crack at the big time, became a free agent, and now as a 28-year-old rookie has done very well. ERA under 2 and a record of 2-1 as a setup man for Donnie Moore in the Angel bullpen. California leads it 5-2 in the bottom of the seventh as we go to New York for a report from NBC News. All right, Bill, thanks very much. And it is our place to bring you these ball games, which sometimes provide some diversion from the problems of the real world, and we don't labor under any illusions about the importance of what we do here relative to the other things going on. But we'll continue and bring you the rest of this ball game. While we were away, we left you in the bottom half of the seventh inning. Guzan had reached on a walk. Sue Clyburn came out of the Angel bullpen. At that point, the Angels led 5-2. He retired Salazar and Rudy Law on grounders, and Felix slid to right to end the inning. Then leading off the top half of the eighth, Bob Boone lined a homer into the stands in left field, the third home run of the day for the Angels. Mike Brown and Juan Benitez had connected earlier. He takes the stand, Stoner breaking ball, a pitch up high, about two rows deep into the stands. That made it 6-2. After that, Mike Brown fouled out, or slide out. Gary Pettis struck out, and Benitez slide out to end the inning. Now we move to the bottom of the eighth. The heart of the order for the White Sox, Baines, Walker, and Fisk. And they trail it 6-2. Clyburn in relief of Urbano Lugo, who stands to be the winning pitcher. Ball one to Ben. It's a very long ball game, and it's obviously overlapping the second half of the NBC doubleheader. You'll see either the Tigers and the Yankees from Tiger Stadium, most of you will see that, or the Giants and the Padres from the West Coast as soon as this one is over.
Big play of the game to this point has been by Gary Pettis. With two outs, two men out, the White Sox already had a run home in the fifth. Baines hit a ball that the wind caught and drove Pettis back to the fence. Might have been a home run, at least that's the basis. Pettis ended the inning with a sensational leaping catch. Could have been three more runs for the White Sox.
Tony La Russa said a couple of weeks ago that from last July on, Baines has been as good a player as any in the American League, and said, La Russa, I exclude no one. And so he was mindful of the fact that he was taking into account players like Eddie Murray and Cal Ripken Jr. and others. He put Staines right with him. There may be some bias involved there. His ball player, but you can make a case for him.
Still in his mid-20s, and he's averaged, what, over the last 2 years, about 97 RBIs. Plays the outfield well. Throws well, runs the bases well. He's almost like a drink. You know, you don't know if he's got a good day or a bad day. He's very polite. Speaks only when you ask him a question. Just keeps that level-headedness throughout the 162 games. Fly ball, center field. Pettit. It's just over into right center with that wind still playing tricks, and Pettis makes the catch. Baines is not exactly your basic quote machine, you're right, but he's averaged those 25 homers and nearly 100 RBI in the season for the past 3 years or so, and that speaks loudly.
This is the year when Baines got off his best major league shot. He said, boy, what number are you going to put on the board?
And all of a sudden, in that month, he's not very many home runs.
He's maintained a pretty decent average. Here's the pure hitter right here. Strike one to him. We mentioned the talk of Bert Blylevin being on the trading block and the Angels being one of the teams going after him. While they're in pursuit of Blylevin, it would be ironic if he beats them a couple of times before they acquire him. He shut them out on Wednesday in Cleveland, and Blylevin is scheduled to pitch against the Angels for the Indians Monday night in Anaheim. And that might be part of the reason why the Indians are reluctant to trade him. They'll wait till they get the games with the Angels out of the way. If they had dealt him a week or so ago, and then he turns around and beats the Indians twice for California, that would be tough for those already long-suffering Cleveland fans to swallow. Waiver deals get tricky. Well, the White Sox, as we said, at least for the time being, blocked any effort on the part of the Indians to trade Blylevin to the Angels, as they claimed him on waiver. White Sox claimed
him. I guess after the June 15th trading deadline, both leagues, in reverse order of the standings, have a chance to claim anybody. And I don't think if this is going to be the American, I got any position, Bob, for Greg Walker. The title is before he was a DH. And fifth of DH on occasion. They were wearing out behind the plate. So Walker went so hard at Al Vermeil, and he's become a very, very good first baseman. Not just adequate.
That thing hit out near the speakers on what was the old wall of the original bleacher barrier back there. Fifth. Deep left,
just
but not deep enough. And actually, it won't make the track. It's way up there and finally comes down in Downing's glove.
Another one of those, of which you can say, last night at the home run. With the wind going straight out to left, the wind just kills that one. Not under a little bit. You think, we've mentioned this before, that at 37 years of age, the tendency is always good. Donnie Moore begins throwing up. He finished off the ball game last night. If you think that a guy want to lose weight, this is about 20 pounds heavier when he came to spring training this year. Much stronger. He's not an ounce of fat, but before he just shortened that swing, the ball just jumped there.
Biddle's one for three, swing and a miss. Well, everybody talks about the possible midseason blockbusters, the Blylevins, the Candelarias, and the others, where Allen Wiggins might wind up. The Tigers made a couple of subtle moves this week that might play a role in the pennant race.
Got a left-hander.
They got Frank Sinatra from Texas, and they picked up Doug Flynn as a free agent after he had been waived to serve as a reserve infielder for them. And the two much-talked-about rookies, Chris Pataro, the infielder, and Nelson Simmons, the slugging sensation of spring training, the outfielder, they were sent back to the minors. Gritz had Kittle play perfectly over near second base, and he fields the soft liner. The White Sox move a run closer on homer number 11 by Walker, but they trail 6-3 after 8. Of the ninth, and Schofield, who's hitless in four trips, dipping beneath 200 for the season in the process, leads it off. He'll be followed by Downing and DeCense against Filner. Strike one.
Schofield had four of his five home runs relatively early this season, and he's on the new shooting and hitting instructor of getting to go the opposite way. He's hitting some breaking balls. He was in trouble last year.
Right side of the diamond. Hewlett juggles, but throws him out. We could stay another day and watch Bruce Tanner tomorrow. Chuck Tanner's son hits for the White Sox. When he debuted with a victory at Seattle, it came on June 12th, and coincidentally, the Pirates were rained out at home that night against the Cardinals, allowing Chuck Tanner to get back home and watch the White Sox game on the satellite dish. And he said it was an even greater thrill to watch his son's first big league victory than to hit a home run in his own first major league at bat, which he did for the Milwaukee Braves.
I had a chance to see Bruce Tanner pitch at Appleton a couple of seasons ago, and he's got that natural hard sinker, kind of like Roger McDowell's up for the Mets. Tanner went about 190 innings. Minor league season without giving up a home run. Boy, everything just sinking and bottom drops down. It's high.
After he beat Seattle in the debut, a whole group of people were lined up to talk to Chuck Tanner on the phone. First, Tony La Russa got on, and the GM, Roland Heeman, and Don Drysdale, Hall of Fame pitcher, who broadcast the game, gave him his report on Tanner's doings, young Tanner. And then finally, Bruce got on the phone and talked to Dad, who congratulated him.
Bright spot, Chuck, here, huh? Not too many others so far this year, or last season.
Pirates did go into Montreal and win 3 out of 4 this week. Probably the best week of the year for them. 2 to Downing. Puts off the bat and the count holds.
Downing trying to shake that slump. He's had a good day today, but he was a slow start of the first half last year, too. So Radisson changed that stance. Remember, he was right up on the plate, wide open stance. Now he's off a little bit and close. He got over 100 points higher after the All-Star break last year. That's 21 to 10 Kaiser set. He'll be up. See you later, Downing. Downing is usually a very disciplined hitter. Ken Kaiser said he didn't hold up. He hits it more and more frequently. He's being called a strike now.
I've got to say, if that's not a check swing, yeah, there really isn't a check swing.
You get a different interpretation of every umpire, not everyone, but the coach. And I've even talked to Dick Butler, the supervisor of umpires in the American League. He told me one time it's the intent of the hitter of the umpire season. I don't know if that sounds like reading mind. Used to be break the wrist, used to be back across the plate.
That strikes me as serious because the intent initially is to start to swing, and then the intent is to stop. The only question is, were you successful?
Now you got it, Chad. That's what Dick Butler's doing. He's being a diplomat with the being a politician. Coming up next, Tigers, Vin and Joe, Giants, Padres.
Cincinnati.
Right.
Unless he caught a rocket out of Riverfront, yeah, after he interviewed Pete on the pregame show.
Well, a lot of bases here. I think he slowed down a little bit, though, couldn't he? I think he could make that. The Hawk is there. Bill Stone and Ken Harrelson.
1-2 to DeCense. Slide out, popped out, walked twice. And Reggie hopes for another team. California. 2-2 to DeCense. In case you're just joining us, California with their win last night, 5-2, as McCaskill beat Bannister. With a half-game lead over the White Sox, 2.5 on Kansas City, 3 on Oakland in the West. Rounded it short. In comes Dijon. The Giants hope to reprise their ninth inning dramatics of earlier in the week. On Wednesday, they were down 7-4 against Oakland with two out and nobody on in the bottom of the ninth. Fisk homered, Gamble walked, and then Walker homered to tie it, and they eventually won it in the 12th when Guillen scored from second on a wild pitch. Now Gamble leads off the last of the ninth, batting for Boston, swings and fouls it back. Guillen is on deck, and then possibly Harrison to hit for Salazar. His next home run will be number 200 lifetime.
Lino is taking a look and thinking. Well, just exploded on Gamble right then. Gamble stays right up on the plate. See those arms and the head will be almost in the strike zone. Loves the ball down low, that open stance. That number here is old for Oscar. It's old for Oliver.
Nancy Faust, a very popular organist here at Comiskey Park, used to play the Oscar Mayer Wiener song. There's Nancy. When Oscar Gamble came to the plate, perhaps because he objected to the kicking out of the Kenny Rogers tune, The Gambler. Stop to short, Schofield, and a nice hop, one down.
Very, very sure hand. It's Schofield.
Second half of the NBC doubleheader. For now, this version of the Major League Baseball Game of the Week has been brought to you by Light Beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer and less. By Ford, who invite you to drive the new Ford Escort. Have you driven a Ford lately? By Gatorade Thirst Quencher. Gatorade is first aid for that deep down body thirst. And by Midas for mufflers, brakes, and shocks. Trust from Midas Touch. That's one to begin.
Tony La Russa with Guillen. Taking all the way, trying to get something going.
He's got to take an MVP.
And Juan Felices at this point, Soundy.
Well, he's got a single, a triple, and a homer.
Two RBIs, runs scored, with a gold star to the center fielder Pettis. To possibly saving three runs, at least two.
That's the single biggest moment of the game. When he robbed Baines, the tide was turning the White Sox way. Pettis saved the day for the Angels. One and two. Clyburn trying to notch the save and get the victory for Lugo. Looks like he'll be one out away. He covers and takes the flip from Benitez.
The Fremont young pitching staff continues to come around the way they have. He told you how many rookies have. Pat Clements, the left-hander's a rookie. He was in the ballgame yesterday. Clyburn and now a rookie. Lugo, a rookie, started. The pass gets started yesterday, a rookie. Marcel Etzen and Gene Mott. Mott would prefer not using Dottie Moore today, I'm sure, if he didn't have to, give that little day off. He's been up and throwing if needed. Then left-hander Skipper up for a while. He was a rookie. He's been sent back down. So the arms are starting to develop through the farm system. Here's that pinch hitter, Jerry Harrison. Pop Sam, apparently Jerry tells him, doing all right. He's been a little ill. Scout with the White Sox organization. Down in Florida. I think he's still hospitalized, but Jerry says he's doing a lot better.
Speaking of fathers and sons, we forgot to give the answer to the trivia question.
Uh-huh.
And now we may not have time.
I forgot the question.
Run the count out full, Jerry. Do us a favor. He's led the American League in pinch hits each of the last two seasons. Take the ball. First, we have to tell you, the executive producer of NBC Sports is Michael Weissman. Coordinating producer for NBC Baseball, Harry Coyle. Telecast of today's game, produced by John Filippelli, directed by Harry Coyle. Pre-game produced by Les Dennis. Pre-game directed by Mary Gita Lamusio. 1-1. Technical directors Neil Flagg and Sal Nagita. Okay.
A lot of distractions. Look at all that debris. Same thing yesterday. There are hot dog wrappers all over the place. There's about 3,000 kids here. They're sponsored by the Shriners. Billy Pierce involved. Now, hit that trivia, kid.
All right, we have now determined there are five father-son combinations in baseball history where each has played or at least been on a team that went to the World Series. Bob and Terry Kennedy, Dolphin Doug Camilli, Jim Bagby Sr. and Jr., Ray and Bob Boone, and Jim and Mike Keegan. Now, in the case of the Camillis, Doug Camilli was on the 63 Dodgers but didn't appear in the World Series. He was a backup to Johnny Roseboro, but he was on the roster. Now the other shoe has dropped. Bonita. Clyburn covers. Clyburn does an excellent job out of the Angels bullpen, and California makes it two in a row in this series over the White Sox, upping their lead to 1.5 in the American League West with a 6-3 win. We'll be back to wrap things up at Comiskey Park in just a minute. With a single, triple, and homer, two RBIs and two runs scored, Juan Benitez is the Lightyear from Miller player of the game, but this was the play of the game. Gary Pettis on Harold Baines' drive in the fifth, protecting a 4-2 Chicago lead. It could have been a three-run homer. Back to Comiskey. The winning pitcher, Urbano Lugo, is 2-1. The loser, Tim Lawler, is 2-4 for the White Sox. Ben and Joe are standing by in Detroit. The Yankees and the Tigers, some may see the Giants and Padres. For Tony Kubek and our statistician, Steve Horn, I'm Bob Costas. So long.